now that need to be taken care of in your district, Derek. There's no reason why you can't, Salt Lake City can't open up a empty building and have all, there are a couple more people camping out right now, and they're dying on the street or in the parks. And they really should be inside where they can have access to a caseworker, where they can develop a relationship, and they can actually have some kind of hope for the future and maybe get off the drugs. We don't want people shooting up on the sidewalk and leaving the needles there. I remember a couple of years ago, one of the staffers used to go down there and pick up the needles from the sidewalk. We don't want that. But I'm disappointed the budget doesn't have that. So I'd like you to work on using the RDA money now to remove everybody from the sidewalk, encourage everybody to go inside, and also storage, camping, whatever. We agree with that. Thanks for listening.
Thank you very much. Anyone else who would like to comment on the amendment number 2 to the fiscal year 2017 budget? Not seeing anyone, I would look for a motion.
Madam Chair, I move that we close the public hearing.
Is there a second? There's a motion to close the public hearing on budget amendment number 2 by Board Member Kitchen, seconded by Board Member Penfold. All in favor?
Aye.
Any discussion? I would add that while we are closing this, we can have another hearing down the road as we add things to the budget, so it isn't the last opportunity to ever talk about this budget. So bear that in mind. Now we have an opportunity to have general comments to the board, and George Chapman and Jason Mathis would both like to say something. If you both want to come up, you can just take turns. Okay.
Okay, this is the big surprise. What am I going to talk about? I'm going to talk about the Rio Grande area, the RDA properties around there, and the fact that nobody is really doing anything about removing the criminal element from there. According to the police chief, there are over 200 drug dealers now. Not a couple of months ago, now. Still there, drug dealers. They're put in jail for a few hours and then they get out again, and they're still dealing drugs. That's what's causing part of the problem. This is the RDA area that's impacted more than anybody. Development will go through the roof if you remove the criminal element. So I don't know what it takes, but you should have the most leverage with the county to get more jail space and open up the 383 beds at Oxbow. Otherwise, there are going to be people preying on everybody down there. And Aaron, you should be really interested in this, because when people are dealing drugs to women, guess how they're going to get the money for the drugs? And that's something we're trying to discourage. And the only way to do it is to lock up the drug dealers. So I'd like to see the RDA board, please use your influence, your leverage, to convince the county to open up more jail space and put the drug dealers in there for more than a few hours. Thanks for listening.
Thank you very much. Jason Mathis.
Thank you. I'm Jason Mathis with the Downtown Alliance. My comments today don't have anything to do with homelessness or drug dealing or the Rio Grande neighborhood, which is a break, because often I have spoken to you about that in the same way that my friend George Chapman has. Today, I mostly just wanted to say thanks to Justin for his long service at the RDA. We learned last week that he is pursuing his dream, and in our Downtown Alliance board meeting yesterday, the board asked me to formally and publicly thank Justin for his service. So I have a letter here that I'd like to read. And it's not embarrassing. It's not nearly as embarrassing as your pants. Dear Justin, I write today on behalf of the entire board and staff of the Downtown Alliance. In our December board meeting, we voted to formally thank you and publicly express appreciation for your dedication, creative problem solving, attention to detail, and incredible work ethic. This letter serves as a formal acknowledgement of our gratitude for all you have done on behalf of Downtown Salt Lake City. During your tenure, Salt Lake City's Redevelopment Agency, you have been an incredible force for good. Few people know the Herculean efforts you undertook to ensure that the Eccles Theater opened on schedule a few months ago. On many occasions during construction and financing, the project faced significant hurdles. In every case, you stepped forward and solved the problems. Your personal efforts brought the project to fruition. When Regent Street is opened and fully operational in a few months, we will have you to thank in large part for that too. We recognize that the Eccles Theater and Regent Street are just two of many projects you have helped to bring to our city on behalf of the Redevelopment Agency. Your unique talent in bringing together public and private interests and investments helped to set you apart as a steward of the public good. You have improved everything you have touched. You have been an asset to Salt Lake City and an incredible champion for downtown. We will miss your insight, deliberative thought process, and good humor. As an organization, we express our deep appreciation for your work and wish you well in your new venture. And I personally commit to being a loyal supporter of your new brewery, even if it is not within the boundaries of the Central Business Improvement District. Thanks, Justin. And I printed this on letterhead, so I'm actually giving it to you.
Thank you very much, and we echo that. Justin, do you know yet when it will be your last day?
Haven't decided on a date formally, but working with Laura and the mayor to identify that.
We're hoping you'll be back for more in January. We're trying to make it fun.
That's the plan.
Okay.
Madam Chair.
All right. Thank you.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
May I have a moment of
you
personal
may.
Privilege? I had the privilege of going to see the performance at the Eccles Theater on Saturday night with my kids. And my kids are fans of Justin Beliveau also, and his children. And as we stood there looking at the plaque in the hallway from the east side towards the will call, that has a lot of names on it of past council members, past mayors, current council, board, RDA members, I felt a serious sense of disappointment that Justin Beliveau's name isn't on that plaque. Because truly, Justin, without you, we would not have opened those doors in the same way that we did just a couple of months ago, and we owe you an incredible debt of gratitude for that. So, Madam Chair, I would like the RDA board to look into the opportunity to name perhaps even the patio outside the area under the Zion Curtain where patrons of the Eccles Theater might enjoy a cold beverage, the Justin Beliveau patio, or some other opportunity that we can get Justin's name on that building.
I think he'll tell you that you have to pay naming rights. Well, he's been really tough on that, and I don't know that he wants to do that, but I agree.
We might
I think
be able
we
to come
to
up with a space that hasn't even been conceptualized
sold yet. Okay.
Madam Chair, we're maybe just a non-compete to sell just his own beer there.
We might need to sample
afraid,
that beer before.
I'm afraid that would be a violation of our purchasing agreements. However, I would strongly encourage him to propose a deal with the Eccles Theater for sales of beer.
All right.
Thanks. I really appreciate it. I'm choked up. I don't know what to say, but thank you. Thank you all for your support.
There will be more embarrassment coming.
Great. I'll brace myself. I wore the right pants for it.
Yeah. Thank you. Not today. In the future. Okay. Thank you. And now we've completed the Justin Love Fest. We will move on. I'm looking for approval of the minutes for, I'll let whoever makes the motion say it. Anyone?
I'll move approval of the minutes of Tuesday, October 25th, 2016, Tuesday, November 1st, 2016.
Second.
And?
Oops.
Do I need to do Tuesday, November 15th, 2016?
Great.
Second.
Let me check on that. Did we?
Yes.
Is that correct? Did we have two November meetings?
That one wasn't
for the
read.
RDA? Is that correct? First and the 15th.
It was just.
Okay, because we did those
the brief ones.
Yeah,
right.
Runs. Okay, then there is a motion by Board Member Mendenhall, seconded by Board Member Penfold. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
The motion passes. Thank you so much.
Madam Chair, I believe that was second was Derek Kitchen.
I apologize. Correct that. It's one of the bearded guys to my left. How about that? Thank you so much. We now would have the announcement from our executive director, who's the mayor, but as you might guess, she's probably otherwise occupied right now. And so we will move on to item B3, the financial audit for fiscal year 2015-2016. And Justin, you want to share with us, and would you like to invite up the folks who did that work? Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to invite Mike Mickelson from Ide Bailey, who's the city and the RDA's auditor. This is something that we do every year. There's an audit of the RDA's financial statements. Ide Bailey's prepared those statements, and we wanted the opportunity to present those to you. I think we do need the board to, I'm looking at Katie Lewis, but I can't see her face, but I do believe that by state law, we need the board to essentially approve the audit or accept the audit. Maybe not. Well, just that you've had the opportunity to review it, I think it should be sufficient for state law.
Okay, go for it.
Okay, thank you very much. Grateful to be here today. As Justin mentioned, we did perform an audit of the financial statements of the Redevelopment Agency of Salt Lake City. When we do that audit, we begin by looking at internal controls. We gain an understanding of the nature and the types of transactions that the RDA has entered into and participated in so that we can assess our risk. And we establish a materiality threshold. And then we plan our audit to detect any misstatement above that materiality threshold. So there is a possibility, an inherent limitation in an audit, that there might be misstatements below that materiality threshold that we don't detect in our audit procedures. But we're required to plan one to detect misstatements above that threshold. After we look at internal controls and then assess our risk and establish materiality, we develop our audit procedures. And you can imagine that having looked at the internal controls and assessed risk, that then the riskier areas of an audit will get maybe a larger sample than the areas that are less risky or less material. We have to do all our work on a sample basis because this is a year's worth of transactions, and I'm still looking for the client that'll pay me to audit 100% of the transactions. But we don't have that much time to spend, and we don't have that many resources, and of course you don't want to pay for us to look at everything, so we do things on a sample basis, and we assign our samples based on those items of internal control, our understanding of the internal controls, the riskiness of the different audit areas, and then the materiality of those audit areas. Then we gather all our audit evidence and determine if we have enough evidence to issue an audit opinion. The opinion that we've issued this year is an unmodified opinion. And so that is the clean audit opinion, and the opinion that says that the financial statements of the Redevelopment Agency are fairly presented in relation to generally accepted accounting principles. So we have issued that unmodified clean opinion. Our audit standards require that we have a couple of more communications when we have a body like this board that is charged with governance of an entity. Those letters were provided with the financial statements in the auditor's report. The first one I want to discuss is a fairly boilerplate. It just summarizes some of the results of our audit. The financial statements do contain estimates. Not every number is something that can be determined exactly. Cash, in most entities, yours is pulled with the city, but cash is the one thing you could pull out of the bank and stack up all the bills and stack up all the coin and come to an exact number on. A lot of the other balances and financial statements are varying levels of estimates. We're required to communicate to you what we think the most significant estimates are. And we believe that the most significant estimate in the financial statements of the Redevelopment Agency is the estimate for the liability for pensions. That is allocated by the city, but the state of Utah, you participate in the Utah retirement system, and so the state of Utah is responsible for hiring an actuary to determine what that liability is, and then they allocate that to all the participants in the Utah retirement system. And so the city has received its portion of the allocation of that pension liability, and then the city does an allocation to allocate it to the different departments and the different component units and the different pieces of the city. And so there are a number of estimates that make up your portion of that pension liability. First, there's the estimate by the state and the actuary there. Then there's the allocation of the state, of the city from the state to the various parts of the city. But then the nature of that liability being an actuarial estimate is what makes that a significant estimate. And so we just need to communicate that so you're aware of the fact that that is an estimate. Estimates by their nature may change, and they may change materially. The state has had an audit of the retirement plan. And then we've done some limited procedures in looking at the information that's come from the state to the city and determining that that estimate is, is fairly stated as it can be right now, and it's fairly stated in the financial statements. One of the other things we're required to communicate is if we have any audit adjustments during the course of our audit. We did have a few this year related to some issues surrounding the notes payable. There was some capitalized interest that needed to be recorded. There was some WIP that hadn't been recorded, and a couple of other things. They're attached to that letter in Schedule A, the corrected misstatements. That is also the item that's in the second letter that I haven't addressed yet. That's the letter that deals with internal control issues that we're required to communicate. We feel that the city does have controls, that this misstatement may have been caught, but the timing of our audit in relation to the timing of those controls this year, there was a timing difference. And so we ended up finding those in our audit and proposing those as a result of our audit procedures. And so we believe that that it won't always be the case, that sometimes the timing will work out and those controls will work in advance of our audit. But because we did find those as a result of our audit procedures, we are calling those audit adjustments and making that communication to you today. Then the final thing I think I need to communicate is that there are some additional schedules with the financial statements in the footnotes that are called required supplementary information. So immediately following our auditor's report is management's discussion and analysis that has some analysis of what happened in the RDA during the fiscal year that we've audited. We don't do a full audit of that information, and there's also some schedules behind the footnotes related to the pensions, the schedule of contributions and the proportionate share of the net pension liability, and then some of the other retirement benefits, the retiree health care and life insurance plan. There's a schedule related to that. We do limited procedures on those schedules. We tie them back to the information that we've audited. We make some inquiries of management as to how those schedules were prepared to make sure that everything's consistent with how the financial statements and the financial information was gathered and prepared. But we don't do a full audit on that information. And so we're just required to communicate to you the nature of the reliance that we offer on that. We issue an in relation to opinion that says that based on the limited procedures we performed, those schedules and the management's discussion and analysis are fairly stated in relation to the financial statements taken as a whole. So we offer that in relation to opinion based on those limited procedures. There are a few other things in that letter with required communications, things like management or any difficulties we encountered in performing the audit, the fact that management has signed a representation letter to formalize some of the representations they made. Because we didn't have any disagreements or any difficulties, I'm not going to belabor the point there. Everything went very well this year in the audit. The information we needed was provided on a timely basis, so it was at hand, and it was all accurate and complete. So everything went very well. Any questions for me at this point?
Board members, any questions? Thank you for answering some of the questions I had. Anticipated them. That was great.
You're welcome.
I would look for a motion to accept the audit.
Madam Chair, I move that we accept the audit.
Second.
Motion by Board Member Penfold, seconded by Board Member Mendenhall. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any discussion about that? All right. It is accepted. Do you need us to do anything else? Or are we good with that?
No, we're good.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. First time I've done this.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for all your help with us and with the city. We appreciate it.
Welcome. Have a good day.
Thanks. We will move on to item B4, Utah Symphony and Opera contract amendment. And Jill will join us, and Amanda or not?
It's up to you. If you want to report on the services, she can come up to the table.
I would love to have you join us, Amanda.
But I'll go ahead and just kick it off.
Thank you.
This is a request to amend the RDA's loan agreement with Utah Symphony and Opera. The loan was for the construction of its facilities in West Capitol Hill. The agreement allows for the RDA to forgive principal and interest every year in exchange for services and concerts that they provide to the community. The current agreement contains an exhibit that is specific to the concerts provided in 2015 and 2016. So what we would like to do is change that exhibit to make it more general with respect to the concerts and services and make it simpler to administer moving forward. Just if you look at the exhibit, there are two things that you will note. One is on the principal forgiveness. In addition to providing that concert at Gallivan every single year, we propose that a minimum of three additional events be added to that list that will activate RDA project areas and benefit the city. And then with respect to the interest forgiveness, we would like you at Utah Symphony and Opera to continue to provide free tickets, educational outreach, and free space rental of its facility. What we would like to do is determine a minimum value that they need to achieve every year. Over the course of 5 years, that value has been on average $430,275. So we would go ahead and say that that is the minimum threshold that they would need to meet. So Amanda is here. She can give you an overview of the concerts and services that were provided this last year.
Hello, everyone. Last year, they did a number of performances for free for the public. Over 1,000 people attended their symphony concert at Gallivan Amphitheater. They also had some musicians at the Marmalade Library opening and did several performances at the Sugar House Art Walk. They also performed some random acts of opera downtown and attended an art access gallery stroll.
Amanda, can I interrupt you for just a minute? You might tell them the thing I didn't see on here that they should get credit for was performing at the Eccles opening.
That was
two string quartets of that.
Right, and that they've already started fulfilling their obligation, their performance obligations for the current fiscal year, and that was one of them.
Okay, so they're over and above. So this ended on July 1,
correct,
this year, or June 30th this year?
Okay. Yeah, actually the end of July, so it's based on Utah Symphony and Opera's fiscal year.
Their fiscal year, yeah. Okay, thanks.
So we're already in talks to perform another symphony at the Gallivan Center, do some more Sugar House art strolls, and some new events coming up.
Board members, questions?
Madam Chair?
Yeah.
Can we make a request for a concert?
I can look into what would work with their schedule, and then we run it by the executive director.
Great.
Yeah.
Okay.
I had requested that the opera come and sing this report today, and I don't know what happened, but oh well.
I have a question, Madam Chair. Yeah. How are we supposed to enjoy random acts of opera if they're random? So I'm assuming there's not a schedule for those. But I do love that concept. So I hope that's happening in the downtown core at random times. Madam Chair, if there's no other questions, I move that we adopt the...
I have one.
Oh, never mind.
It's more of a request, and it's my vote isn't contingent on this, but in their letter, they state that they reached out to 44 elementary schools. And I'm wondering if that reaching out, I know from writing nonprofit grant reports myself that reaching out doesn't necessarily mean connecting. And so I'm wondering if the numbers of 26,000 that are in the, I don't remember where in here, I saw 26,000 people have been engaged. Anyway, but I'm wondering if they're counting reaching out with connecting with those elementary schools or not. So my request would be that we get more clear numbers about how many community organizations, schools said yes and actually engaged them in some kind of collaboration.
We do have a complete list of where those
total audience
or those connections were made. So I can summarize that and get it.
That would
more
be
information
great
for you.
Thank you.
Now I'll look for motion.
Madam Chair, I'd like to acknowledge several years of a great partnership with the Symphony in providing services to the residents of our city and to visitors, and move that we adopt the updated contract.
Second. Motion by Board Member Penfold, seconded by Board Member Johnston. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any discussion? Okay, the motion carries. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks to both of you. Now move to item B5, the amendment number 2 to the FY budget discussing urgent funding, and would like to invite Laura Fritz, the Chief Executive Officer and the Head of Economic Development. Justin is here. Jennifer, do you want to join us at the table? And Ben, do you want to come up as well, please? Both from the council office. Thank you. All right, go ahead.
Thank you. There are 5 items that we've identified as being urgent funding needs. By urgency, I probably ought to identify the urgency. The urgency is that where things stand in our 16-17 budget, we have, through the adoption of the first amendment to the budget, funded our operations through a portion of the year, and we are now running low in some areas of funding where we need to replenish those funds. So the purpose isn't to say this is an emergency situation, but it is getting to a point where, in order for us to be able to move forward with the activities that are covered under these items, we do need to have funding so that we can continue those activities for the rest of the year. There are 5 different areas on which we are requesting funding currently. Those would include covering our temporary property expenses for the remainder of the year. This covers things like the payment of property taxes, insurance, and routine maintenance of the RDA's properties throughout its project areas. That request is for $466,010. And it is spread among 4 different project areas, including the Depot District, Granary District, Central Business District, and the West Temple Gateway project area. Second request is for $300,000 for professional services. This is a request from our program income fund. The purpose of seeking funding for consulting services, or professional services rather, I should say, is this relates to the transactional nature of the business that we do in purchasing and developing and selling property. So when we are making an offer to purchase a property and going through with acquisition activities, we need to conduct due diligence, which often will require appraisal and environmental investigations of the property, and potentially even remediation once we acquire the property. And then as we own property, in preparing it for disposition, there are oftentimes numerous steps that we need to take to prepare property for sale, such as environmental remediation as an example, or again, appraisal of the property. So this request is to establish a fund from which we could draw in the future for those transactional needs for the rest of the fiscal year. Third item is the North Temple Banner Program. This is something that was funded, I believe, in a prior year. I can't recall. I don't have the specific information of when it was funded. This is funding to complete our obligation to NeighborWorks, who's our partner in that project, to fund the ongoing obligations that they have to complete that Banner Program in the North Temple project area. This probably should have been identified in our previous budget discussions as an ongoing obligation. There was some discrepancy in the billing, and we needed time to evaluate that with NeighborWorks. They provided the satisfactory information, and now we've confirmed that this is an expenditure that was contemplated, and so we need to fund our obligation on this item.
Justin, I believe we started that the year we started the North Temple project area, but can you tell me, do we renew those banners every year, or are we're hanging the same, basically the same ones, but they go up and down, or? I'm just mostly curious about if we're looking at refreshing those or renewing them, or if we are just doing them as part of the annual.
I'll look into that and get back to the board.
Thanks.
The fourth item is the study. It's a request for $50,000 from the Depot District to conduct a small area plan concerning property that the RDA owns in the vicinity of 100 South between 600 and 700 West, in conjunction and partnership with UTA, who also owns property in that area. So this would look at the overall redevelopment potential of our property and UTA's property. UTA is contributing $44,000 to that effort. And the last item is a request of $55,399 from the Central Business District. This is to complete the installation of the 300 South Flying Objects, or Flying Objects 5.0, which will be installed on 300 South. This was an appropriation which was made by the board in the 2015-2016 tax year, and or fiscal year rather. And this funding is for the remaining portion that is owed to the Arts Council, which they owe to the artists. So in essence, these funds have been encumbered, and it's necessary to complete the ongoing work to install the flying objects on 300 South.
Madam Chair, Justin, two questions. I know it's not much, but why the difference between the UTA funding and the RDA funding request? There's about $5,000 difference there.
I think I need to ask Ed, Kara, or Suze, or Jill for that information.
And then, council members, the flying objects is has been a pet project of mine for a long time, and this actually gets them installed along 300 South, which has become a little bit of a corridor for flying objects. This program was originally a temporary art project started by the RDA probably 10 years ago, and the quality of the submissions by artists was so incredible and amazing that the RDA was actually able to buy some of these from the artists. And so having this sort of permanent yet rotating opportunity along 300 South, I think, is a real asset to that corridor.
Madam Chair, and I guess I just have a couple of questions in regards to the 300,000.
Thanks.
My questions, Justin, and maybe to Laura, is why are we looking at $300,000 in a lump sum instead of looking at it by project area? I mean, if we're going to go out and we're going to get appraisals on properties that we own within RDA project creation areas, why aren't we allocating that money to these areas? In addition to that, when we're looking, do we have strategic plans for acquisition in RDA project areas? Like if this property came up or this property came up, do you have a list of 1 through 10 of available properties that are interesting or you'd be interested in purchasing?
We don't have a specific list identified in project areas, although in the project area plan for North Temple, for example, it lists strategic acquisition opportunities as something we ought to pursue. So if we were pursuing an acquisition, then this would be funding that would assist us in that effort. I think to answer your first question, it's an issue of needing to have funds in a location that would allow us to be as nimble as possible. And the alternative would be to budget in each project area, as you had suggested. And I think the issue there would be to need to predict at the outset or when we're adopting the budget exactly what our expenditures would be in each of those project areas. And then that could present a situation where one project area needs more of those funds. And so every time we needed to reappropriate funds, we'd have to do another budget opening, is my understanding. So it's an effort to make sure that we're able to move quickly and nimbly as acquisition and sale opportunities, but more likely acquisition opportunities come up, and to have a pool of funds that we could draw upon in order to undertake those activities as quickly as we can without needing to, again, initiate a budget amendment every time that we were looking to undertake those activities.
Can I follow up on that? That last time we met, I think it was in our brief meeting, that I asked for specifics about just what James said, and I don't see any specifics articulated in today's packet. That's disappointing. And I think part of the nimble ability that would come with this type of allocation from the board is also what, as a board member, gives me pause about our own ability to have oversight over the projects as they happen. It's a fine, there's sort of a razor's edge that we get to balance here between handing money to move nimbly and being able to make sure as a board that we are doing our responsibility of oversight of the policies that we've created as a board in these project areas. So that's where I'm uncomfortable with this. And also that the last time we saw this, am I mistaken in remembering that there was talk about professional services for strategic plan creation for the few of the newer project areas?
That's been funded elsewhere in our budget. We do have a line item for project area creation. And I believe that budget was around $250,000. And our expenditures for project area creation is roughly divided into one-third portions, one-third for each of those project areas, Nine Line, State Street, and the Northwest Quadrant. If the board would like more information about those expenditures, I believe you'd requested it at the council briefing that we had last week. And happy to provide that information to you. I can provide it now if you'd like as to what those activities are and whom we've engaged and what the amounts are for spending that budget.
I would like that information. I don't know that everyone else would, and so if you want to get it to me otherwise in a different format,
no, that'd be fine. I would like it as well.
But so am I understanding that you found that money from a different fund, but that we, am I mistaken in understanding that it was through this request previously? That this $300,000 of professional services we had previously been informed was to employ outside consulting for strategic planning on those new project areas?
No, they're two separate items. And I believe we presented it as such when we presented the original budget.
The the board approved it's $266,000. The board approved it in the July budget amendment. I think the numbers might have been conflated because the kind of uses are sort of similar. And the amounts are kind of similar, but
it's probably my mistake because my memory of it is much more recent than July. So thanks for helping me weed out that I made a mistake in my understanding there, but I would like to know the details on that.
We'll follow up with an email of that information if that's sufficient.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
One follow-up question on this as well. What's the tracking mechanism for using the $300,000 in funds that would be reported back? Is there a process in place you have or are planning on having so we would know where that money was spent, essentially?
We didn't have anything specific in mind, but certainly open to any ideas that you have for that tracking. Mm-hmm. I think it would be fair and reasonable to request some reporting to the board of expenditures from that account, and I'm not sure how frequently you'd like to do that on a monthly basis, quarterly basis, but we're open to any ideas that you have.
Yeah, I think my intent, at least in this, is to make sure that we're all aware about where the resources are going. If we're going to have a shared account for the flexibility, it also means that there's not necessarily any reason to make sure it gets spread across all areas. I'm not saying it has to be, but we tend to sort of gravitate towards what's available. And if one area tends to have a lot of properties at one time, it may eat up all those funds and unintentionally become the focus of a lot of this funding. So I just want to make sure we have something in place to monitor that at some reasonable period of time so we can follow up and know where the money's going and those resources are being allocated. So.
Madam Chair, can I jump back in? Because Andrew has brought it up a point more articulately than I did, that I think our concern, you know, we want the Northwest Quadrant to happen. Obviously, we expedited the creation of that project area, and yet there's concern for me on my part that there will be a prioritization that bumps other project areas. And so I think tracking of those investments will help me as a board member to have a clear understanding of how the staff's resources are being prioritized and allocated to the different project areas and make sure that we have the balance that we want as a board. So, Madam Chair, how could we schedule a future meeting, kind of a budget breakdown maybe?
Yeah, I think Justin's question about how frequently, I'd say not monthly. please.
Quarterly maybe.
Quarterly?
I don't know what's a reasonable amount of time to make sure that we are tracking it but not micromanaging to the point mm-hmm. that it overwhelms everything else we're trying to do.
Frequently in the general fund, there are a couple of other things that are like this where the council doesn't necessarily want to have approval authority over every single check that's written but wants to know sort of the general direction of things. And the biannual report is fairly common, or the quarterly report is very common, or the yearly report. So all three of those time periods are present and working in the general fund context. So sure. You could choose.
Based on just a guess, maybe Stan or someone else has a better idea of this from history, but 6 months seems like it would be a decent amount of time to see transactions on a larger enough level to see patterns or anything along those lines.
Twice a year, then, you're saying?
I look to the board to give me some direction here.
I would be in favor of quarterly, and if we feel like that's too much after a couple of rounds of it, then let's space it out. But we're moving quickly on a lot of things right now, particularly in the Northwest Quadrant, not necessarily in land acquisition. But anyway, for me, I'd like quarterly.
Madam Chair, I think I would actually agree that quarterly seems appropriate now, but I would recommend we do it as a written report. I don't think it needs to be scheduled on the agenda. I think we could get the information we need through a written report. But if it's listed on the agenda as such, and we look at a quarterly reporting, that would be comfortable for me.
Well, and then if anyone has questions about the written report, they'll have that opportunity to discuss it. Okay. Go ahead.
No, I just know that I'm still on that UTA question, so I just didn't want to forget it.
That's why you came up. Okay. Yeah. Thanks. Good afternoon. And yeah, the UTA is working really hard to upgrade their bus garage, which is a very large expense for them. So 44, like a multi-million dollar project that they're trying to allocate funds to. So I believe that's why $44,000 was what they could come up with to be able to match our funds. And just to clarify, those are to be used as matching funds towards a grant application with the WFRC Transportation Land Use Connection.
So it's a $95,000 matching grant. Is that what we're looking at?
We are looking to match $94,000 of a $150,000 request. So our match is really the bulk of that at this point, but we've asked WFRC for the rest.
And so I'm not too concerned about it. It is a minor difference, but the study really looks at mostly UTA property. Is that accurate?
UTA owns a greater number of acres in that area, yes, than the RDA does. But I guess when we talked about it in our meetings, the idea was to get a comprehensive plan for the whole area, especially in light of what plans have been in place for Station Center.
So we potentially might be expanding a little bit beyond just the UTA property that they're looking at turning over.
Yeah, that's right. We would look, at the RDA and UTA properties and just have hopefully some resources and tools that other property owners could use if they want to redevelop their own property.
UTA managing this grant? Proposal.
So their $44,000 is their contribution to the grant.
Are we managing it, study?
The $50,000 that we've requested in the budget urgent funding needs is what we would put towards the grant.
But who's managing the grant? I mean, is UTA going to manage the grant study, or are we going to manage that grant study?
Manage it? Is that what you said?
Mm-hmm.
We would. Municipalities are required to apply. It would be through the RDA, through Salt Lake City has applied. We did the letter of intent.
So we did the application.
Yeah, we did the application. We were essentially shortlisted. The final grant application, the full application is due January 19th.
Thank you.
Further questions? Any of this? All right, then I would look for a motion. And if you want to add in the language for things we discussed, be brave, be my guest.
At the end of the staff report for this item are some sheet. Potential motions.
Yeah. If you go to page 3 of the staff report, you can see potential motion language. So is there anyone who wants to take a crack at that?
Sure, why not?
Okay.
I move the board adopt the following urgent budget items as part of the budget amendment number 2 of the fiscal year 2017. Want me to go through all of it, each piece?
Do we need to?
In the council setting, we've been advised by the attorneys that I'll look to them to correct that if it's in the record and you just reference it as it's as it's listed on the motion sheet because it's been a public record, that's sufficient.
Okay.
You don't have to read off every number.
All right, as listed with.
Second, looks like we've got a question.
I just wanted to point out, I believe the motion sheet, we may want to confirm, but I think it leaves out the $50,000 for the small area plan study.
Oh, it does. My apologies. It does. Sorry about that. You would have to add that in verbally.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll look for you in a second to add that in. as is written with the following changes, the $300,000 from the Program Income Fund for Professional Services with the understanding that it is contingent upon quarterly written briefings, reports?
Reports.
Reports on its allocation, as well as, remind me, the $50,000. What was it for again?
For
the small area plan.
Area plan.
For this RDA property small area plan study.
Okay.
Second.
Motion by Board Member Johnston, seconded by Board Member Penfold. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, any discussion? Good with that? Okay, the motion carries. Thank you very much. All right.
Madam Chair, and if the board wants to set a public hearing date, you might want to consider that motion now. Otherwise, you could always set the hearing in January for a February hearing. There's no time required to have a hearing in January. It's just an option.
Board members, is there a desire to have that public hearing in January? Yeah. I need a motion then to set another hearing date for January 17th, 2017.
So moved.
Continue it.
Second.
Okay. Motion by Board Member Penfold, seconded by Board Member Johnston. And we will have a hearing comment period from the public on the usage of RDA funds at our board meeting in January. Thank you so much. Okay, moving right along. We are now to the exciting part of our meeting to talk about affordable housing fact-finding, which is really a big and important thing right now. And we would like to invite, who are we gonna go with first? Let me just pull up my information. Our RDA staff first?
I think we'd like to kick things off with Housing Neighborhood Development.
Housing Neighborhood, okay. And so, Michael Ackerlow, you wanna come forward, please? And whomever you'd like to bring with you. And by way of information for the public, if you did not see the packet that came out on this, we have reached out to different entities that are involved in housing in the city and in the state, and we gave them specific questions that we wanted them to answer, and we will probably go on from there. And we're beginning with Housing and Neighborhood Development, and we'll let you launch in. Thank you for being with us. And will you stay in the mic?
Yes.
Your names. Thanks.
Mike Ackerlow. I'm the Director of Housing and Neighborhood Development. I'm joined at the table by Melissa Jensen, who is my deputy in Housing and Neighborhood Development. And I'm going to stretch for a moment this discussion because our presentation is not loaded. So here it comes. Maybe. We'll just start talking about housing. So we wanted to start this discussion today by talking about the city's housing plan. And really, I think it's an important part of the discussion to have because it sets up the framework for a very good and thoughtful and doable plan of action for our city. This plan will be a five-year plan. The last plan that was done was in 2000, so a lot has changed in the past 16, 17 years in the real estate market, as you all know, and we really wanted to do a plan that we could react to, that we could make sure things happened within a certain amount of time. So
So what we want to do today is show you, talk to you about what's in the housing plan, because I think it will guide all of us as we talk about funding decisions or policy decisions. Yay, there it is. How do I make this full screen? Here comes our surface guru. I wanted to start out with a timeline here to show you what has been done up to this point. And because we've done a lot of really good work in hand and with our partners, I did notice as I read this that I've actually doubled up on a couple things. So while it looks like we're really busy, there is a couple of duplications on there, but we have been busy. Last year in December of 15, the council adopted Plan Salt Lake, which was really good for us to have some guidance on housing goals for the entire city. This year in February, the council adopted the housing policy, which was good for us because it gave us the framework to move forward on the housing plan. In March, we had our housing finance group. We have briefed you all on the recommendations from that group. This was a group made up of real estate professionals, financiers, advocates. We had Utah Housing Corporation. We had Amy Rowland for National Development Council. We had a really good group, including city staff, to talk about what kind of financing tools are out there to do affordable housing. We also updated our market study, which we presented to you in this fall, which gave us some current data on our housing needs in the city. We also started in August a public survey, and we had a tremendous response to this. We had 1,700 to 1,800 responses on this survey, which has really helped us understand how the community sees housing and what their needs are. We also did some outreach to the West Side neighborhoods. Community United did that research. They went to a number of events, talked with people, spoke with people about their needs. And I think what's remarkable about this, and the board and the council should take note, is that oftentimes when we have conversations about the needs of affordable housing, we're not hearing it from those who need it the most. These are people who can't attend council meetings because of perhaps work schedules or language barriers or for other reasons. And yet are being left out of the conversation. So our goal there was to have Community United really get involved with those groups and find out what their needs are. This fall, we came to you and talked to you about the finance working group recommendations. We also presented to you the update of the market study. I believe we had some really good discussions with you about the housing needs in our city. We continued to do some outreach. We had two open house type meetings with our consultant from BBC who did our market study, got some good input there. So really it's been up to this point a lot of data gathering and writing. So here is the vision for the housing plan. It is that Salt Lake City is a place for a growing and diverse population to find housing opportunities that are safe, secure, and enrich lives and communities. We've taken that goal or that vision and broken it down into three goals. The first goal is to increase housing options, which means to reform city practices to promote a responsive, affordable, high opportunity housing market. Our second goal is regarding affordable housing, increasing housing opportunities for cost burdened households. And our third goal is to create an equitable city. And by that we mean opportunities throughout our city for affordable housing and to make sure that people are not discriminated. So I'm going to take you quickly through. We're going to come back to you with the housing plan, and I'll show you a timeline here in a few minutes. But I did want to kind of give you a high-level overview of what we're doing. And that first goal, which is to increase housing options, this comes from a lot of work we've done looking at the future of housing in general in Salt Lake City and the limitations that we have due to our current zoning or other policy issues, process issues, and the cost that it puts on developers and housing developers in particular, and those who are doing affordable housing. So Salt Lake City is becoming a place that people cannot afford to live in anymore. So we are losing people to the suburbs. We are not getting them, we're not keeping them here. I know for me, I bought my home in the year 2000. I could not afford to buy a home here now. And so I'm just staying where I am, and we're gonna live in cozy quarters, but we want to we want to stay in the city, and I can't afford it, and I maybe some of you are in that same position. We need to look at city policy and city zoning to increase housing types and densities. So our objectives in this are to modernize land use and zoning regulations to reflect the needs of a growing and pioneering city. We want to reduce impediments in city processes to new housing development. We want to lead the Wasatch Front in development of innovative housing solutions. And finally, provide residents, community advocates, business leaders, and elected officials with high-quality housing data to drive decision-making.
Madam Chair, I just have a question to follow up with those. Actually, on your first three, modernize land use and zoning regulations to reflect the needs of a growing pioneering city. Do you have any idea what that entails? Or maybe, and actually one through three, if you could elaborate on.
Absolutely. So when we talk about modernizing land use and zoning regulations, we are missing a segment of housing in the city. We have a lot of high density and we have a lot of single family. Single family is becoming harder to build because of a scarcity of land. We've seen a real boom in multifamily, but we're not seeing a real boom in affordable multifamily. In fact, we're probably at a loss in our multifamily. So we are missing a segment where we could kind of a medium density, townhomes, smaller apartment complexes, smaller lot sizes that would allow for smaller homes like cottages or bungalows that are still affordable. So we are missing a part of that segment. So when we look at this, we want to not only look at how our land is zoned, but also are there any zoning requirements that we could put in that would make affordable housing a requirement in any type of development. So we're looking at a few things there, but we really need to expand what our inventory is like in the city so that more people can live here. Following that, reduce impediments. We want to make sure that our city processes here are clear, that they're easy to get through, that we have people to assist our developers. Every time we postpone a permit or a loan or something like that, the costs go up. And when costs go up in affordable housing, they have to pass those costs on to their renters. So our goal is to reduce the impediments, make it an easier process for developers to come in and get affordable housing. And then finally, I think leading the Wasatch Front in the development of innovative housing solutions. Earlier this summer, we launched the Housing Innovation Lab, which is a place where we can encourage developers to look at innovative solutions for affordable housing. We opened our passive home on Emory Street, which was a single family home. But we are also looking at a wide range of products. What can we do for ADUs? What can be done in existing multifamily? Townhomes, there's a number of different things that we could do, other cities are doing, so we're looking for some of those best practices. Does that answer your question?
It does. And how will you coordinate with, for example, building services to make sure that, and actually planning to make sure that we are, you know, streamlining the process so that we don't have to go back and forth between developers and the city?
Right. In each of these objectives in the housing plan, you will see specific strategies that we're putting together to do these things. We will be working, we have had some preliminary discussions, but we will work more cohesively with these groups to see what's happening there to slow development down. That's going to take some time, but we can get there. We have looked at how internally we can assist developers, kind of a hand-in-hand type thing where we can take them through the process. There's one key person rather than having to go to planning or going to building permits and getting different types of information, that they actually have someone who is their liaison, their person to help them through the process.
So your real housing plan, when we get that, we'll have all those details.
Yes.
And I know this is the million-dollar question. How soon until we get that?
I'm going to tell you in a moment.
Okay.
But
great.
Very soon.
Okay.
That's the teaser. I'm going to make you stay awake for the whole presentation. Our second goal is one that we talk about a lot, and that is affordable housing and increasing housing opportunities for cost-burdened households. And if you see here, we didn't say necessarily increase housing units, because that's not what this is all about. It's a number of things. It is certainly about more units, but it's also about finding ways to keep people in their housing. To preserve affordable housing. So our objectives in this would be to, first of all, prioritize the development of new affordable housing with an emphasis on households earning 40% of AMI and below. And we've discussed that before, but we know this is our greatest need. This is where our 7,500 units come from for those who are earning $20,000 or less in our city. This is the hardest to do because it requires heavy subsidies and in many instances requires case management or other program or services, and those also cost money. Number two is pursue funding sources for affordable housing programs. We've had discussions with the council about significant funding sources and ideas, and we'll be pursuing those. This isn't, as we've mentioned before, this isn't a problem that can be resolved with a few million dollars here or there. It's going to require a significant amount of funding to not only produce new units, but to keep people in their housing. We want to stabilize very low-income renters, secure and preserve long-term affordability, work with landlords to both improve their rental units, as well as renting to very low-income households. And finally, we want to increase opportunities for home ownership.
May I ask a question? One of the questions I wanted to ask you that I think could be answered on this page is that it's about sort of a formula that shows how we structure our investments across time so that we could look at a different kind of a timeline that whose outcome is the goals that we have, which is housing in perpetuity, but it also is making an immediate impact to address the needs, particularly with 4 new homeless shelters coming online in the next few years that are less than half of the beds that we're currently serving at, we have to get moving. Mm-hmm. So can you talk about that in the context of these objectives? Mm-hmm. Might we see some kind of a formula timeline in your plan when it gets to us?
Yes.
But in the meantime,
what can we do?
The clock is ticking.
Right. So we have in particular, one item coming to you in January, which is a community land trust. And we've spoken to you a little bit about this before, but this is a way to preserve affordable housing in our city. We've done a lot of research on it. Melissa has led that charge. We have worked with national consultants. We've studied best practices, models that work and don't work. This is a great way to hang on to our affordable housing in perpetuity. And, you know, it's one of the things that really frightens me most is that when we look at these neighborhoods that we're redeveloping and we're seeing these new exciting buildings come up, which is fantastic because it helps us with the economic development of our city. We also have to face the reality that as that happens, these home prices go up and soon enough people can't afford to live there anymore. So how do we as a city get those properties into some kind of tool that will keep them affordable? And the house and the community land trust is a great way to do that. So we have briefed the mayor on it. We are coming back to her with some more information, answering some questions that she has, and hope to be sending that to a transmittal to you in January with a proposal or a way to get that done.
Can I ask you what kind of money is it going to take to do that, and have you earmarked where that could come from?
Sure. I think just to add to the previous question, I mean, part of the challenge with urgency and immediacy is making sure that you're giving enough thought and deliberation to what you're going to do as a seed for long-term strategy, so that as you're doing bold and big things, you're leading to a much larger and bigger plan to ensure that that impact is sound for the future. And so when we think about what can we do now, it's all part of how is that going to feed into the long-term plan. And another issue, and one of the big things that we talked about with the finance working group, is the funding source, right? And so we're still exploring that and the many mechanisms, which will take some time to really think about the right strategy for the city to fund affordable housing for the long term. However, with that in mind, there are some mechanisms and tools that are either extremely low cost or leverage current city resources. And I believe that the Community Land Trust is an example of something that can be leveraged internally with minimal cost that we could absorb initially. I mean, certainly for long-term strategy, we would want to look at additional support. But because the city owns land currently, and we have trust funds and RDA resources that go towards loans, it's a mechanism that can be used with little or no budgetary impact.
Madam Chair, I had a follow-up, and I'm glad you went ahead, because the other question that I wanted to ask you about is how do we capture the opportunities that are in the pipeline today of projects that are coming at us that may not have any or quite as much affordable housing as we would like to see. So is the Community Land Trust also the tool for that, or are there other immediate actions that we could look at that could happen before we get to a final plan much farther down the road?
I have to say that that's one of our top priorities, is to make sure that we're not overlooking priorities now or opportunities now. And that's key for so many resources, but whatever money comes in, we want to make sure that in 15 years that housing unit, whether it's single or multifamily, isn't turned for market, because city resources are extremely valuable. And so as we look to what we have on the table today, we are considering perpetuity on a consistent and ongoing basis, and not considering even 40 or 50 years enough.
Can you speak at all, though, to the how we intervene, how we begin a conversation with developers who aren't coming through hand and they're not maybe considering affordable, but they're doing projects in areas that were that have the kind of potential that where we could begin a conversation about including that? What are you allowed to begin those conversations? Is the administration looking at taking advantage of those opportunities now?
I think so, and I think with the administration and the RDA, we've spoken about this a lot recently in terms of how do we gain access and visibility to things that are not traditionally affordable. Where we see the most opportunity for that is in preservation. So as new developers are coming into the market and looking to buy up properties or purchase properties, we get visibility to that, namely the RDA, more than hand directly. And so we're working on how to reach out. We had a meeting this morning with a developer about preservation, that very strategy, to make sure that as these units are being absorbed by market rate developers who want to improve housing stock, which is great, that we can retain that affordability as we go forward, either through incentives, low interest loans, et cetera. There it is harder to ensure that that unit is going to be affordable beyond a 40 or 50 year term, but certainly is not something that we're overlooking. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, I think what I would hope is that perhaps we, if we don't quite have a strategy outlined about here's our approach and now give us some affordable units, that at least we might have an open door with developers. We have at least a handful of great developers who have done affordable housing in the past and might be willing to implement that in projects where they hadn't considered it before. And at least that open door to say, tell us what it would take to get that ball rolling in that direction. And
with the Community Land Trust, you are asking for the ownership of the land to go into this trust. So that is a different structure than most developers are used to. And our goal is to create some kind of way to get them to do that, to put that in the trust. Right now, our best tool is our housing trust fund, which has a requirement of 55 years of affordability. But like Melissa said, after 55 years, we lose that. So the Community Land Trust is something that's been successful. Certainly any city-owned property can go in there, which is a great start. But you're right, we need a better way to get developers in there and to contribute their land. So we're working on that. We're trying to figure out a way to make that something that they'd be interested in and willing to do.
Okay, I have an administrative request. I'm not an administrator. I would love to see our administration hold a summit, a workshop, invite all of the permits that are currently in the pipeline that could work with us, potentially, that have some... you could envision a potential, maybe they can't quite yet, and you hold some kind of event where they come together and you talk about how early we are in these stages and yet that there is this amazing housing boom happening in Salt Lake City and that we don't want to neglect an opportunity that is their projects in front of us now, and have a conversation about how in these early policy planning, budget planning stages, we still might be able to take advantage of a relationship there. I would love to see our city do something like that.
You heard the mayor today in her press conference mention the Blue Ribbon Commission that she's putting together, and she has been working with developers, with large property owners in the city to come together and do exactly that. So we are working on, we're hoping to have that meeting here at the beginning of the year in January, trying to get some final details put together, but you're exactly right. It's getting people in the room together and finding a way to make that work.
Thanks.
Stan?
So, two related questions on affordability and the time frame for implementation. When we're talking about 40% and below, we clearly have identified with the direction we're going with new resource centers that we will have the need to provide some housing beds for those, the discrepancy between what we're currently serving and the capacity of those resource centers. That's a 12 to 18 month timeline. And I'm not seeing anything up on your goal that projects programming in that timeline, and that would be 40% below primarily. And the second part of that question is that I don't think any of us have an expectation that all of that housing for the beds above and beyond what we will be projecting in the future should be in Salt Lake City. So how does your department coordinate with countywide services or other entities when we're looking at that pretty dramatic need in the next 12 to 24 months for 40%, 20% highly subsidized affordable housing?
We certainly have been involved with the county on the funding that has come from the state on housing, on providing these units. There's the $3 million. We've also been involved with the state with the National Housing Trust Fund money that's coming to our state and how that can be used.
So Mike, actually, to put some more parameters around that, if you could respond. The suggestion based on this is construction of new projects. We don't have time to do that. I mean, the construction timeline for new projects is the same construction timeline for resource centers. So what happens so that that availability comes online at the same time that we start shifting this model to resource centers?
You know, it's an excellent question. I'm gathering my thoughts here for a moment. This, we know this is going to take time. We know that one of the critical parts of this is the funding. We also know that there are a number of people who are in jeopardy of becoming homeless, and how do we help them stay in their existing housing? How do we get people in? How do we get people in the shelters right now into housing? We are not only are we exploring these long-term solutions, like what we do with the housing trust funds money from the federal government or the county money, is what can we do now? We have used housing trust fund money to buy down construction costs. To get units from 60% AMI down to 30% AMI. The low-wage worker fund, which we've brought to you before, is doing that. It's interesting to look at how quickly money goes. And you may get $1 million, which you think is fantastic, but that can be 15 or 20 units is all. So there are things like that that we are trying to do. And I think as we go through this housing plan, like I mentioned at the beginning, this is a 5-year plan, but it doesn't mean we're waiting 3 or 4 years to actually see results. We're trying to do things right now to get people into housing.
So two thoughts I have about that is that the examples you provided are traditional models, and we know the funding is evaporating on those. We have no reason to expect otherwise in the near future. And at the same time, we're seeing a significant increase of the number of people losing their housing and showing up on the streets, 14 to 16% estimate for new homeless population. We're not even keeping up.
We're not.
And so as we look at this, I want to be very realistic about how we are addressing the problem, because I'm concerned that we continually sort of reference these historical models, and it's pretty evident to me those aren't going to work. The other piece of this that's concerning to me is that I think there's probably, there may be a need for a pretty significant role for the city to play with other government entities around how do we advocate for affordable housing in a system that is not providing affordable housing. And I am having a hard time imagining Salt Lake City meeting this demand. And I don't think we can from a cost perspective, but I also think it's not a responsibility to. I'm not trying to deflect that responsibility. I just don't think it's financially feasible for us to fill this demand. So how is that role captured in your five-year plan, or is it?
It is. I mean, it's a discussion we have often. We're certainly proponents of a housing first model, and we see that work. My concern with the housing first model is that the funding isn't there, and we are seeing permanent supportive housing units grow, but we're also seeing the number of people in our shelters grow, and so we're missing something. Are there better programs up front that we could do to help people gain better employment, gain better education? Are there things like that, obviously, that we can do and we are doing with our federal funding? We are trying to think outside the box on this. I do think the low-wage worker fund was something that the city came up with as a way to help buy down units. We listened to our developers, and that's what they said they needed, and we've been trying to do that. We've seen the state do something similar with their funding. So yes, it's part of the discussion we're having as strategies in this plan to consider new ways to do this. I mean, we're concerned with tax credits and the availability of tax credits. It's extremely competitive. There is hope that those could grow. There's some proposals in D.C. to have those grow. We're looking at, the state has announced an increase in the state allocation of tax credits. There are voucher programs that need to be discussed outside of the federal voucher program, which would be a very creative solution to keep people in their housing. So, Board Member Penfold, we are exploring these ways, but it's difficult. It's difficult using the tools that we have right now to meet this need. So we're trying to find these out-of-the-box solutions.
I think, too, in terms of collaboration, we really understand that we can't do this alone. And as you see the county and the state both tackling this issue on a broader basis, it's one of the priorities of the administration and the mayor, as we've spoken as well, about how do we do a concerted effort? Because if we build it, they will come regardless, and we can't shoulder a burden for everyone who needs affordable housing. It's unrealistic. At the same time, those who need stabilization services. So a new unit is a very easy formula. Amy and Claudia will talk to you about costs and subsidies, and you build it, and there's math, and it's very clear. When you're talking about a hard-to-serve population and programming and case management services and foreclosure prevention, that is extremely complicated to begin to understand the right price point and model to make that work. I think Mike's right. There's certainly more room for innovation. And part of the Blue Ribbon Commission is not just about new units, but how we really address the complex issues of humanity that intersect with housing. And that is a much larger and more difficult task, but is certainly something that we think about all the time and understand that we can't have that conversation alone.
As we move forward, I'll be really interested, committed to seeing a strategy that is very specific about how do we, in the next 18 to 24 months, bring sufficient capacity online to support resource centers and the new model. Mm-hmm. So as you're looking at your timelines for that, the sooner you can get some tentative objectives in there and specifically some numbers, I think the more helpful that will be as we move forward in the short term, understanding that you're also balancing that with the long-term problem and the long-term challenge, which shows no signs of changing. So thank you.
Okay.
Go ahead. I'm teasing. On number five, when you have work with landlords to improve their rental units and rent very low-income households, how do you do that? How do you see incentivizing that? The thing that we hear a lot is that the road home will get housing for someone, and they will move them into housing, and it is a cockroach-infested, horrible place that nobody really wants to live, and it's really tough to get landlords to improve that. So
That's a really nice general statement, but do you have any specific ideas of how we can accomplish that?
Right, we're working on that right now. We're looking at different funding sources and incentives to get landlords to do that. There has to be some kind of an insurance program for them to know that if things are damaged or whatever, that they can improve those units. I want to make it clear, though, that I think there's been some discussion that the road home is putting people into terrible units. And I'm sure that happens on occasion. We have older housing stock in our city. But they go through a process where they look at these units and they try their best to get people into housing. And there's a discussion we have with them about, is it better to have them in no housing or in housing that might not be
that's
the newest
not great.
Housing? Right. Yeah. And it's kind of a hard discussion to have because you want them to have housing, but you want them to have good housing. Sometimes we see developers or landlords take advantage of this a bit too, and we want to offer a program where they feel comfortable, where that they can lease their unit to somebody who is low income and feel confident that they'll get paid and that the unit will be taken care of. So that is this program that we're looking at. We want to make sure that they are not discriminating against those who are low income and that they also feel comfortable with the condition of their units.
One thing I would really advocate for is that as we're helping to move people into the housing, if we could set up some kind of program to help someone who's been on the street a long time to learn how to live in a home again and to take some pride in their home and maybe even if it's only paying a dollar to be there so that they feel like it's theirs and there's some investment and helping, you know, especially when you have kids who've like aged out of foster care or something like that. And if they haven't been given really a skill set to know how to take care of someplace, I understand why a landlord might be nervous about renting to somebody who's not going to understand or know how to take care of something. And it's not their fault. But I would love to see us say, before you get into our housing, we're going to have a program to help you succeed in our housing. And again, it takes money, it takes caseworkers, it takes all of that. But I think we want to make a commitment to that and have it be successful.
Agreed. There's even the little things that I think most of us take for granted that we know how to do, fixing a small repair around the house or making sure we're paying our utility bills on time or buying the right types of products for our home. And you're right, there are many people who don't have those type of life skills yet. We have discussed that in our office. Nothing comes to mind. I don't think there are any current programs. We have some programs that teach kind of the higher level of how to live in a house, but really those day-to-day needs, I think that is being missed. So we can look at...
And as we've talked about before, that like you don't do your grocery shopping at 7-Eleven.
Right.
But if that's the closest place and they're in a food desert, it's tough and it's not going to be healthy and it's not going to be cost effective. Right. Anyway, okay, thanks. Go on. Now I'll let you continue.
Can I have one question, Madam Chair?
Yeah.
Is that within the scope of what you're talking about, though?
Well, I think
supportive programs for skilled based development.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's all included. What we know from developers who work with hard to serve populations is some of these issues. And we know that capacity is limited when you are a caseworker who has to serve 50 people. I mean, so I think it's really about creating programs and stabilization services that lend to the success of both the agency and the end user. And right now, I think there's many cases where both are set up to fail. So while we may not administer those programs, certainly as we think about stabilization services, we are considering that because it's critical for long-term success. Housing First is the first step. And I think that we can't forget that when we think about units. Really what we're talking about is long-term stabilization that housing can provide with the right support.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
So I just wanted to follow up on what Board Member Rogers asked a little bit ago about working with planning and other divisions within the administration. And I guess what I'm hoping for is a confirmation that we will be receiving specific proposals from the administration about how we might move forward with the zoning changes so that we may address the missing middle. But also, and I ask this just in light of impact fees and the not, you know, us not receiving a specific recommendation from the administration. I'm hoping that we can also get a recommendation from y'all about how we might find a consistent and ongoing revenue stream for the Housing Trust Fund. I know there's a lot of ideas out there, but I would like to see something from the administration as far as a plan goes for that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's what this plan does.
Okay.
Is it now puts that framework. We don't want to jump into something where we're putting funding into housing unless we know how to best use it. And this is a strategic plan to do that. I think the importance of having a five-year plan also is that it keeps us, it keeps it more relevant. We're going to see market changes here over the next few years, and we want to be able to adjust to meet those needs.
So are you also anticipating a rising interest rate and how that might affect the market?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that is a scary thing for many people. So absolutely, that's part of the conversation.
Well, and part of the plan is so that we can be flexible as the market changes. So if we get to a place where vacancy rates increase, it's going to be a much different conversation with developers about filling units at a subsidized cost. But we want to make sure that we are agile enough, have the resources behind us, that we can do that as the market changes. And that's not a structure that we've had previously.
Now, I guess I'll wait for the transmittal on the Community Land Trust to really dive into this, but do we anticipate that to be a program outside of the city in some capacity, or how can you give
me some
insight there?
We'll explore that as part of the transmittal. We've discussed that. I think it's we don't have any decisions made on how best yet to do that. It may be that at some point it is best to spin it out. It's probably not something we'd want to manage, and there aren't many cities. Some cities have their own, but there aren't many. I think we want to make sure we do that right. So that'll be part of our transmittal to you.
I'm just also imagining that there's a lot of private philanthropic dollars waiting to be tapped into, and this might be a great way for us to leverage some of those.
Great point. Yeah.
Thank you.
All right. Should we move on to goal three? Final goal is equitable and fair housing. This is addressing some of the discussions we've had with the council about where our housing is going in the city and making sure that housing of all types and for those of all incomes to be anywhere in our city. We've talked about areas of opportunity where in creating areas where opportunity doesn't exist and where there is opportunity, making sure we have affordable housing in those areas. So we want to make sure that we are aligning all of our resources to do that. We also want to make sure that we are eliminating housing discrimination in Salt Lake City. And that is something that does happen. We have some data on that and where people are being discriminated. And so we have nonprofits, we have groups, community groups who work with that, and we'll make sure that that they're included in these discussions to make sure that we eliminate housing discrimination in our city. And then finally, looking at life cycle housing principles in neighborhoods, this is really getting back to a community where we have housing of all types and where a single dweller can find a house as well as a family. Someone who's aging in place can stay in their home or find housing. We want people there from the time they're born to the time they... are
exit
retired and enjoying life. I don't know how to say that. Yes, exit. Maybe before then, hopefully. But we want to provide all types of housing in our city. Like I said at the beginning, our city is we're seeing more and more this split of this multifamily and the single family, but we aren't seeing opportunities for young families to stay in the city. And we do receive calls from families who graduate from college and they have a good job, but they can't afford to live here and they want to live here. It means they have to commute here. It increases air pollution. There's so many other factors. But 81% of our workers in the city are in commuters. So we want to find a way to keep people here.
Madam Chair,
yes.
Mike, thank you so much for including that. You know, that's been a big cause for all of us here on the councils to make sure that we're creating opportunity, not just in certain areas, but across the city. So thank you to you and your group for making sure that was included in this.
Great. Thank you. Let me just finish up by talking about what's next. We have our draft housing plan done. We are reading through that and making final changes to it. It'll go to the mayor. We have a meeting with her next week. We've already presented much of this information to her, but this will be the complete draft that she'll be reviewing. And then a final presentation the first part of January. We'll be sending a written briefing to the council on the housing plan so that you have information on what's in there before it goes out to the public. There is a planning commission briefing that we'll have in January. We're hoping for the end of January. We're coordinating that now. And then bring that to you in February. So you'll have the actual plan with public comment and planning commission comment to you in February.
Will that be at RDA or will that be at a council meeting?
That would be a council meeting.
Okay.
And so this is our goal. We know it's a tight timeline. We're pushing hard. We really wanted to have this wrapped up by the end of the year, so we're a little behind schedule, but I think what we have will reflect good work and thoughtful work, and we hope to have that plan adopted the first part of the year.
Great. Okay. Further questions on this? Let me ask Justin, does the RDA have additional things, or is this...
I would just add that we're working very closely with Mike and Melissa on this. And I think, if I could have a moment, I think it's important for us to take stock of the things that the RDA already does. And then what we view the outcome of this exercise and the development of the housing plan is that we will then more closely align the way in which we're deploying those resources and doing the things that we already do. We'll be doing them in reference to and in furtherance of the plan that's adopted. And I think that's probably the most effective way that we could deploy our resources to support affordable housing is if we're mapping back to the plan that Hand will be presenting to you. So just a list of some of what I think are the key things that we do routinely to support affordable housing. They include, right at the top of the list, partnership with developers. And there are a couple in this room with whom we've had great success in partnering in delivering to our community really high quality affordable housing. And these are folks who express a real willingness to listen to our needs, to challenge our assumptions, and to make sure that we're getting the best out of our investment in affordable housing projects. And so you guys have taken some steps to streamline our property sale process, our loan programs, tax exempt reimbursement. I think that will only enhance our ability to partner with developers to achieve our affordable housing goals. A few other things, of course, when we're selling property, the first end of that is strategic acquisition. And we have a unique ability to tap resources that aren't otherwise available to Hand to acquire property in difficult to develop areas and to repackage it and repurpose it for addressing our housing needs. So that's another area where we will more closely align with Hand. When we sell property, we have the ability to write down the purchase price of the property. And I think that's another effective way in which our efforts, our ongoing practices, can align with the development of perhaps a community land trust. We also have, as I mentioned, our loan program and tax exempt reimbursement program. And the steps that were taken recently in refining those programs have identified affordable housing as one of the top priorities. And we've established some criteria by which we would use those programs to incentivize affordable housing. And I would expect that as we go through these discussions, once a housing plan is developed, we may come back to you and ask for some revisions to that plan to get to a more deeply targeted level. But I really think we ought to take stock of the steps that we've already taken on those programs. And then, of course, we invest in infrastructure. That really lays the groundwork for the development to take place in some of these areas, and in some respects can be one of the keys to reducing or mitigating the risk that's perceived in developing in areas. Affordable housing projects are often some of the best pioneering economic development projects to undertake in a new project area, and oftentimes they require the investment in infrastructure to support those projects in order to assist them in penciling out. So that's something that we've historically done and have the ability to do going forward, that again, I think each one of those items we would do and do in a way that maps back to the plan once we're final in developing and presenting it to the council.
Madam Chair, it would be a disappointment if I didn't bring this up since we have these two lovely and sharp individuals in front of us we wear our RDA hats. I wanted to ask if you don't mind updating us on the Fleet Block. The Fleet Block is in the middle of an RDA project area, and it has an immense potential for development of affordable housing. Mm-hmm. And so I would like it if you could take this opportunity to update the RDA board on plans and timelines for the fleet block.
Absolutely. Matt Dahl, who is one of our deputies in hand as well, is he here? Actually, if you're okay, I'm going to have it turn over to Matt because he's working on this.
Good, excuse me. Good afternoon. Is this really loud, or am I just talking really loud into it?
It's just actually really working. So after years of having it not work well, it's working incredibly well.
Wow, okay.
Thanks, Matt.
So with regards to the fleet block, what we've been working on over the last few months is having the environmental condition of the property reassessed. We're working with Terracon, and they have gone through and done some additional sampling on the site. It turns out that there is more significant issues that we need to deal with, and right now they are in the process of, they've done the first round of sampling, and they're going through and doing another round. They will be doing another round of sampling in order to determine the extent of several different contaminants that are on the site. In the meantime, we're also working with the state to address some petroleum contamination on the south end of the property. So in the next 4 or 5 weeks, you're going to see one of the buildings come down because the oil has gone underneath that that building on the south side, and we'll put a fence over there. As soon as we get a handle on some on what these environmental conditions are and what we think the cost and methods for dealing with them are going to be, I think we'll be able to move forward faster with the plan. We had put together, and I think I even presented it to you last summer, some plans for that site. And as part of that, one of the directions was that we make sure that we understand all of the different infrastructure and environmental issues on that site more in depth before we really accelerated with the project. And that's what this is part of. And it is something that we know we can find a solution for. It's just been a little disappointing and has hindered our ability to move forward with the project.
That help?
It's nice to have an update, but it doesn't help me understand where we're going with the property.
Well, if you remember last, like I said, I think it was last summer, last spring, we presented a look at the project, looking at it from the perspective of moving forward with a innovation district on the site, and that included opportunities for housing as well as different types of commercial uses on the site. I don't think that that general concept has changed, and we were looking at moving forward with an RFQ or P with the site, but and that's something that I think we will be moving forward with in, I would hope, is well in 2017. But the contaminants that are on the site are going to be costly to deal with, and we're going to have to figure that out first.
Councilmember or Board Member Kitchen, we certainly have had discussions about what the future of that site can be, and we see it as a huge community asset for not only housing and commercial, as Matt mentioned, but also public uses as well. Right. We look in that area, there's a lack of schools. It would be, we could use open space there. We could see a number of local businesses as well as larger scale innovative technology businesses there. Certainly housing is a component of that. We have been looking internally on a mix of housing and incomes in that area, so we don't duplicate what's already there but provide housing that meets certain gaps. So while Matt is working diligently on getting the site cleaned up, which is a huge undertaking and it can also be very costly, and we don't want to skip that because when we bring in a developer, we have to know what we have on that site. We are also having those other discussions about what does this site look like? How are we going to fund it? What's the best structure with the developer? Is it better to bring in one developer or many developers? Those are all parts of this conversation. So we're really heading down two paths at the same time. But part of that, what we end up doing there really depends on the environmental condition of this site and if we can get it cleaned up, as well as the utility connections in the roads. So those are all, we have a lot of groundwork, so to speak, to do on this site to make sure that it can be developed.
Thank you.
Yeah. Madam Chair, if I just may say, add something to Justin's comments. and this may be one of the last times we present while Justin is here. We've had a great relationship working with Justin, and in particular the last few months as we've worked on the housing plan with the mayor. We convened a meeting a couple weeks ago where Justin and Laura were both in attendance, and before that spent some time with Justin talking about ways we can better collaborate with the RDA. We were impressed at the ways we already are working with them, but we also identified a number of tools and things that we can do to further and more quickly achieve our goals. And so I just want to thank Justin for his input and his expertise in doing this and his support. We see the RDA as a great partner, and I think as we move forward, we see a partnership with the RDA as well as the Housing Authority as really important to change housing in our city and provide stable environments for those who live here.
We appreciate your working with us, and I'm not going to let you go for a minute.
Okay.
With the Blue Ribbon panel that you mentioned, the mayor graciously invited to have a council member serve on that. Looking to David and maybe Laura, is that one or two council members? Because I thought now would maybe be a good time for us to nominate at least one person, and then if you desire to have a second person, that we would do that. And we appreciate having the opportunity. When I met with the mayor, we talked about it, and she was kind and said, "Do you want to say who it is?" And I said, "No, I think that the board needs to decide that." And so I'd love to have a conversation for a minute if we can just hit pause and the next presenters can hang on, and we'll go ahead and make that decision today. Is that agreeable? So board members, we're missing Charlie. He was called out for a meeting, and Derek ought to be back in a minute. I'm betting Derek has an interest in this, given that he's from District 4.
Are you suggesting we nominate the two absent board members?
They aren't here to defend themselves? Yeah, that's good. I'm pleased to have anybody who, you know, speak up for yourself if you have an interest in doing it. I'd love to know that, and we can talk about it a little bit. Aaron?
I have an interest.
Is there anybody else who... Is
I have an interest.
You have an interest too, James? Yeah. Okay.
No, yeah. I really do. I really do have an interest. I think that it coincides with what I do on a daily basis that I think I might be able to add to.
Okay. I really don't want to make this decision without Charlie and Derek here, because we want to do that. So perhaps we'll circle back to this, but I'd like to make the decision today if we can. And when lobbying can go on, I suppose. But anyway,
I'd like to formally nominate James Rogers.
You would? Okay. All right. So that's all right. We'll check with Derek, and then we'll go from there. Thank you so much. This
Thank
is
you.
Really helpful.
I hope this was helpful.
Are there any additional questions for our astute panel while they're here before us?
Thanks.
Yeah. Just thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay. All right. Who are we going to hear from next?
Well, we have three guests that we could hear from. We could invite each of them up to the table, and then maybe we do it alphabetically.
Okay.
If there's nothing else. But Claudio O'Grady from Utah Housing Corporation, and Amy Rowland from the National Development Council. And then we also have the Housing Authority represented as well. If you guys would maybe make an introduction, we'll start with Claudia first, and then work our way to the right, and then maybe you could ask questions of this panel.
Madam Chair,
okay, yes.
Before, as they get settled, was I took notes and they were good points, but was that the RDA portion of the presentation, Justin?
Yes, and really the message is we are working with HAND to develop the plan, and that plan will guide how we deploy our resources for affordable housing.
Okay, can I just, you don't need to respond to it right now, but make a request that we get some specific advice on this board's allocation of $4.5 million for Eastside affordable housing, that we have some specific direction from staff, that advice on how we strategically use that money to the highest and best, and perhaps in helping us define what Eastside is. Thanks.
And actually, I'm going to just throw a little wrench in this. I'm going to ask Claudia to stay, and I'm going to have you two get comfortable in the audience for a minute, and we'll have you come up so that we can really focus on each group. Yeah, okay. we're okay. Friendly. Whoops, okay. You've seen we're not too. We don't try to be too difficult. So
happened to me in the 12th grade, but
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. You wanted that support, yeah. But I want to really have good focus on okay. What you have to tell us, and you're on the Redevelopment Advisory Committee, right?
I
go
am,
go ahead
am.
And introduce yourself and tell us a little bit, as well as Utah Housing Corporation.
Yes, yes. I am Claudia O'Grady, and I am Vice President of Multifamily Financing with Utah Housing Corporation. I'm also on the Redevelopment Advisory Committee. In my role at UHC, I oversee the Low Income Housing Tax Credit Program for the state of Utah, and that is probably where I want to focus my comments here. I know I have limited time, and I don't want to overwhelm you with details, but I think it's important for you to understand what the Low Income Housing Tax Credit Program does. We allocate tax credits on an annual basis to developers who build affordable housing. We deed restrict that housing for a period of years. It has been in the past 99 years. A lot of our housing in our portfolio is 99-year deed restricted. We recently moved to a 50-year deed restriction for a variety of reasons. But the program is responsible for about 95% of the production of all affordable housing in our country today, and probably in Utah it's a little bit higher than 95%. There just are not financing programs available to do new production of units. We are guided by an allocation plan on how we allocate our credits. We update our allocation plan annually. We try to respond to housing needs across the state, given different demographic shifts and trends that we see, and the changing tide of development that we see year to year. We try to adapt our plan so that we are responding accordingly. An example of some of our priorities that we've established include siting issues, which is a big theme that I've heard here today, location of affordable housing. One of the siting issues that scores very highly under our program is a relatively new scoring piece. It's areas of opportunity. And we've established criteria that rank every census tract by the opportunity it presents. We had James Wood from the University of Utah Kim Gardner Center develop that scoring matrix for us. We think it's a really good matrix. So we highly prioritize areas of opportunity, which I think coincides with some of your goals as well.
I may be jumping the gun on this, but do you want to tell us what yep. some of those look like?
Yes, the areas thanks. Of opportunity, there are five criteria which go into areas of opportunity. School proficiency, access to employment, housing stability, wages, and there's a fifth one, access to healthcare. I think that's the fifth one. Those five elements combined, they're all scored together, scored on an average basis. And if you can bring a project in an area that ranks high in one of those in areas of opportunity, you get a lot of points, and that's really going to favor you heavily in the competition for tax credits. So another area, a siting issue that we emphasize heavily, which we're kind of taking a look at these days, is transit-oriented housing siting. So if you're within a third of a mile of walkable distance to a track station or a core bus route from UTA, that also scores very heavily under our program. So we think that having access to transit and living in an area of opportunity are probably two of the most important goals right now under the Housing Credit Program, where we can put our affordable housing. The 9% credit, you probably know this, it's a competitive.
May I interject?
You may, please.
Will you define transit?
Yeah, transit for us is it's tracks, light rail, and the core bus routes as defined by UTA.
Great, thanks.
So the 9% credit is competitive. We have a limited number of 9% credits. That's the credit that everybody wants because it generates a whole lot of equity into a project and makes it feasible. the 9% credits, we allocate one round a year. We allocate all of our credits in one round. We just don't have enough credit to do everything that we all want to do. It is a very highly competitive competition. And in fact, on Thursday, we will allocate all of our 2017 credits. You will have a new slew of tax credit projects in Salt Lake City. You know, those are the projects where you can really achieve 40% and below. Our average AMI in our 9% portfolio is 42% AMI.
Claudia, do you have any figures on what that equates to in the number of units or developments? Either number of projects or actually number of units would be most helpful.
The number of units in Salt Lake City?
Annually that you're able to fund with your...
Yeah, annually with the 9% credit, we're able to fund about, on the affordable side, it's about 500 affordable units, but that generally is mixed with some market rate units. We think that's an important element to our developments as well. So the blend, we get about 700-800 units, new units out there every year under the 9% program. In the last year or so, you've seen a big increase in 4% tax credit projects. Those are the tax-exempt bond financed projects. And those are affordable as well, but they're affordable at a higher level. They're affordable at 60% AMI and below, generally. They have to be right up there at that 60%. They have less equity, but they're still affordable and they're still deed restricted. We've been doing, this past year, we've done, gosh, about another, I want to say about another 1,400 of those units just in the past year, because just the economics of what it takes to put together a deal like that are really just right now. We'll see how long that lasts, but we hope to keep that production going for a little while at least. One aspect of the program that I want to emphasize with you is the compliance piece of what we do. Compliance, we have an entire compliance department with auditors who go out to each property annually and inspect the property, inspect tenant files, and ensure compliance. That's a very big piece of ensuring that the program serves who it says it's going to serve. And that is something that I might just put back to you, that if you are looking for ways to create affordable housing outside of the credit program, that's the compliance aspect is going to be a very difficult challenge to manage. And I guess that really wraps back to what I want to say, which is that I hope that you strongly consider leveraging your resources, maximizing as many units as you possibly can from a single dollar of investment. And I think the best way to do that is to combine it with other programs like the tax credit program that is able to do, to you can generate more units by putting more money into it. So instead of, if you invest $1 million into a project, it's not to make the project $1 million fancier, it's to make more units, which may involve some planning and zoning issues as well. I really think that leveraging is the best strategy. Yes.
You, seeing our need, and the growth that's happening right now and the ability of collaboration, the potential for collaboration with these housing partners, do you off the cuff feel that we could fulfill our needs strictly through collaborations and have something like, say, the compliance component completely fulfilled by our partners? Or do you foresee that we are going to, in that kind of cocktail approach of community land trust, maybe vouchers, who knows what all of the components we will choose, that we may end up needing to have a compliance component on our own?
Well, if you are utilizing other, if you're not intending to leverage other programs, or if you happen to invest in something that does not leverage other programs, you will need a compliance person, people, department. I don't know how large that level of investment would get. I think that's a good reason to incentivize partnerships.
Have you seen other municipalities do that?
No. Generally, the resources are all combined and leveraged, and I think it's very difficult to do. It's also very expensive to do, as you know, without bringing in the other resources, either Olin Walker dollars, home CDBG, some other source. tax credits, then it becomes very, very expensive to do, and that can really diminish your ability just to do more units.
Thanks.
So, one last resource I want to mention that we have that I hope we can work more with the city on is the state housing tax credit. I don't know if you're all aware that we have a state housing tax credit in addition to the federal credit. The state credit we use to do exactly what you're trying to accomplish, which is essentially buy down the rent on an existing tax credit unit from, say, 60% AMI down to 40% AMI, or even lower, if that's what the need is. So we have the ability to use those resources and drive down rents. It is combined with the federal program, really because of this compliance issue, in large part. The new piece of affordable housing legislation that you may have read about recently up at the state is proposing to expand our state credit by threefold. So we will multiply our ability to buy down units by about threefold coming up here soon. So that is the low income housing tax credit program, and I think it's a very important part of your strategy. I hope it is. From year to year, we may see more or less projects and units here in Salt Lake City, and that really all depends on a variety of factors, scoring issues mostly. But we like to see these partnerships, and we think that if we could come up with a collaboration that incentivizes development here in Salt Lake City, I think we'd see more projects.
Madam Chair, could you expand a little bit on the state housing tax credit? And I know they expanded by threefold, but what does that actually mean?
So there's a state tax credit, and it is used in combination with the federal tax credit right now. So we allocate state tax credits when developers come to us and say, I have these 50% AMI units. I would like to drive them down to 40%. Well, there's just a cost. There is a dollar amount that associates with that drop in rent. And in order to make that up, we can allocate state credits. They sell those credits to an investor who may or may not be the same as the federal investor. And the investor puts in equity to the project, and it has to be used for the specific purpose that it is created. So in this case, it probably just takes off a slice of the debt so that the rents can actually be reduced.
What's the number we're talking about? I said increased by threefold, but compared to the federal ones and everything else, what are we looking at here for state?
It's a much smaller, we get much less credit. Under the current legislation, we get 12.5 cents per capita, and that is, so that amounts to about $375,000 of annual state credit, which we allocate for each of a 10-year credit period. That's going to jump to, I can't remember what the rate is, three times that. So we'll have far more credits to allocate. And the issue is, there has to be an incentive for developers to do this. Just like, you know, you've proposed that maybe the city work with developers who have something in the pipeline right now, and what can we do to incentivize them to make some units affordable? That's the challenge. They could go ahead and do all market rate units and be happy. They could do 60% AMI units and be happy. We have to find a way to incentivize them to utilize that state credit and market to renters at 35% AMI instead of 60% AMI.
So that brings it, if somebody's existing, an existing developer wants to do a development that has some affordable units in it, say 60%, right? The tax credit helps them drop that down to a lower.
The state tax credit does, correct, right.
How effective is that for folks who don't have any affordable in there to induce affordability in a development?
Well, it's actually the state credit has to be used in tandem with the federal credit.
So if we're out of federal credits, it doesn't help us at all. Is that
right.
Accurate?
That is correct. That is correct. The state credit is not of help in that situation.
And is that one of the cruxes of the state incentive program they're coming forward with? The recommendation from Lieutenant Governor's
commission. We've discussed that a lot, and quite honestly, I'm not really sure where the legislation landed on that, but we did discuss that a lot on the Affordable Housing Task Force, the Lieutenant Governor's Affordable Housing Task Force.
Yeah.
That was one of the big issues. Do we try to find a way to incentivize market rate landlords into renting at reduced rents? That is a very hard ask, and it is paying them for doing that service. Whereas if you do this in combination with the tax credit program, that's already there. That incentive is already there. So that's why it's certainly a lot easier under the tax credit program when you use that state credit combined. I would say the same thing with any subsidy dollars that you use to drive down rents. It is going to be much easier to do if you go to a developer of one of these 4% deals, 616 Lofts, Granary Place, or the Hub is coming in Salt Lake City. So, you know, there are a whole bunch that where you can approach those developers and say, you know, we have some funds and we'd like you to drive down rents even further. But it's so much easier on a project that is already affordable at some level.
What percentage of the federal tax credits are going towards Salt Lake City projects versus other projects in the county or the state?
Well, it, as I said, it varies year to year. Last year I think was a big year for us. We did a number of projects along the new tracks line that goes out to the airport, a number of low-income housing tax credit projects. Mm-hmm. That probably consumed, I want to say, about half of our resources. Yeah. This year it might be a little less.
Pretty typical, though, year to year, half to less?
Yeah, it is.
Claudia, this is a competitive process. Do you have any sense of the number of units you have in the application process versus the number you're able to fund?
Yes, we get, under the 9% program, we get about 3 applications for every one that we're able to fund.
Okay, thanks.
Mm-hmm. Any further questions?
Yes, just one.
Yeah, go ahead.
You kind of answered my question about, I was going to ask you though, maybe you have a little bit more you can give us. It's been very helpful. If you were sitting here on the council and trying to figure out ways to increase that pipeline, what would you say?
Excuse me. I would, knowing that some of your priorities, knowing what some of your priorities are, I would look to the partners and try to match those priorities with how we're funding projects. For instance, areas of opportunity, that's a big one. Well, land in areas of opportunity is much more expensive. So on the one hand, developers under our program are going to, they want those points for areas of opportunity, but the land is more expensive, so it's going to make it far more difficult to do. You know, some of what you can do is to write down some of the cost of land in those areas to make it more affordable for them. But, you know, look for land in areas of opportunity. Look for land in qualified census tracts because that generates 30% more equity in the program, under the program from us. So I would look to what other programs, how they are structured, and see if you can match your priorities and you know, sort of help those fit in so that they score better in the process. You know, I think that the commitment that the RDA board has made in terms of dollars is very significant, but that can not, if you aren't really strategic about those investments, it cannot go a long way, and like you would like to see it go a long way.
Thank you.
Yes.
And I have a question for you. If a developer really knows how to do this, what would be the maximum amount of tax credits available? If they're able to leverage mm-hmm. state, federal, and whatever else is out there, do you have any idea of what that would be?
Yeah, well, under the federal program, and any one project can qualify for up to $1 million of annual tax credits. But as I mentioned, it's for each year over 10 years, so it's actually $10 million of tax credits. Currently, our tax credits are being priced in our market exceptionally high. You know, I would say something average is about $1.20. In this last round, we had one come in at $1.34. So tax credits are extremely, you know, they really gin up the equity in a development. So if you get $10 million at $1.34, that's a lot of money into the deal. In addition, the state credits, we really don't put a cap on that. So just, you know, tell us what you want to do, and we'll work with you. We are only limited by how much we have available to allocate each year.
Madam Chair, one more question, if you could. One of the concerns from folks, say, on the west side of Salt Lake, has been because land's cheaper there, and they can use the TOD sort of criteria, you get a concentration of those developments in that area instead of spreading out across. Can you talk about that at all? About how do you spread these out across different geographic regions? Because you're talking about leveraging dollars for the best bang for the buck, which makes total sense. It also means then to consolidate these into cheaper areas, right?
That has happened, but that's something that we're looking at. We're looking at how much of our resources we've put into TOD areas, the level at which we put those resources in. We still think it's a very important priority, but we put in extra resources if you're located in one of those areas. We're looking at that for future rounds of allocation, but. You know, the same incentive applies for East Side TOD, and we just don't see that happening along the East Side TOD, and it's just a question of land cost, and land availability and land cost. And but what we have implemented that we hope helps address some of this issue is the areas of opportunity. Areas of opportunity, you will find more of them centrally located and maybe on the East Side. So we hope that balances out some of that development. We hope that that developers take advantage of that incentive.
It sets us up a little bit. Aaron talked about this, is that how do you balance out the two things, competing interests of getting bang for the buck with areas of opportunity? And they to this point, it seems like it hasn't happened. I mean, we haven't been able to incentivize folks to go to areas of opportunity because it's much more expensive, obviously, and there's a good reason for that. I understand that if I'm doing this development, I'm doing the same thing. But it's an inherent conflict for us. Then how do you weight those things too differently to get more of a spreading of resources across an area like Salt Lake City or other areas in the valley?
Yes, and again, I would go back to the partnerships that you have with other funders, the way you are able to leverage those dollars. I think that's really the key strategy.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, can I have one more?
Yes, go ahead.
This is so enlightening to listen to you, thank you. And in the context of our hand discussion before, I am really wanting to actually see a mapping of the context of the critical or the criteria for the areas of opportunity in the city with the transit overlay. And in terms of us prioritizing how we allocate this funding, and when we consider projects, hopefully the administration's going to have a bunch of projects that crop up in the next 6 months that want to come and request funding. That money will go hot and fast if we aren't, and not as far if we aren't really strategic about leveraging the most out of every dollar. So as a request to hand in the administration, can you produce that for us the next time that we get the, I guess it's in February?
I have those maps. I'd be happy to send them to hand.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thanks so much.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
Well, just one last question. Sure. Do you have a sense for the type of units you're seeing? Are you seeing studio, 1, 2, 3 bedroom? What is the mix of what you are typically seeing in your applications?
You know, that is such an interesting question. I watch this very closely. We do incentivize development of 3 and 4 bedroom units because statewide there is certainly a need for 3 and 4 bedroom units. We don't see that the predominant unit mix in Salt Lake City is studios, 1s, 2s, a few 2s. Studios, 1s, a few 2s. The developments where they have tried to incorporate 3-bedroom units in Salt Lake City, they are not rented to families. We've discovered their roommate situations, which is great. You know, they're still getting the economic benefit of living affordably, but our intent was to do that for families. And really, the main usage we see is studios, 1s, 2s.
Thank you very much. We're hearing some anecdotal information from developers that there's a increasing demand for 3 bedrooms, but it's been hard to quantify that. And so that's helpful information. Thanks.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Now, we'd like to invite Allison Rowland to join us. Amy, gosh, Allison, come on up. You know, and okay, I'm just going to say it right now. We're really lucky to have Allison on the council staff, and this is her sister Amy, and I just would also give a shout out to your niece who plays in the band at Stephen Colbert, and I saw her in person, and it was she rocked it.
I haven't gotten to do that yet. Next month, I get to
sign up. Anyway, thank you for being here. Give us a brief introduction, and then launch in.
Okay, I'm Amy Rowland, and considerably older than Allison, even if I'm not taller. And I am the area director for the National Development Council. National Development Council is a nationwide group where the headquarters is in New York City, but we're really spread across the country. We do a number of things. We do technical assistance. We do trainings, classes in community and economic development finance. We actually have an equity fund that invests in low-income housing tax, or has a fund that invests in low-income housing tax credits, new market tax credits. So we have a wide range of services. In Utah, I'm the sole staff person. I'm mainly here to help facilitate community development, economic development, and affordable housing development projects. And my background is really affordable housing. The last 3 years now that I've been with NDC is the first time I've really gotten into more business development, economic development. My whole rest of my career, long career, has been in doing affordable housing. So that's really my main thing. So to take 5 minutes and talk about affordable housing is kind of hard for me. It's like 30 years worth. So mostly I think I'd love to just, you know, repeat a little of what Claudia said, which is the leveraging. Just really focus on, you know, this is resources you're wanting to put into affordable housing, and we want them to go as far as possible. So leveraging them with the low-income housing tax credit is really critical. I know you want to say, but can't we break out and do affordable housing that we don't have to be in that competitive process and we don't have to compete for those funds? And I just say, if you want leverage, that is by far your best bang for the buck. It also gets you that compliance that is not easy to recreate on a city level. I have worked in a lot of cities that have their own compliance. It's mainly because they have something like inclusionary zoning. They have a specific, I worked in California for a long time, and so if they have a specific requirement for developers to do a component of their all housing as affordable housing, then they do have to, and it's if there's no tax credits involved, they do have to recreate a compliance department, and it's a lot. I mean, that's a big issue. So if you're a city that has to make sure that developers are coming in and they're not only producing 20% of their units for low-income families, but they continue to keep them that way, you do have to have your own internal department that makes sure they're doing what you've told them they have to do. So it happens, but it's a lot, and you guys aren't, at this moment, Salt Lake isn't really set up to have that kind of full compliance. Just to keep that in mind if you're going to go off the tax credit track a little bit. And I can see you struggling for what's the short-term solution. You know, what can we do in 24 months with these resources that gets housing out there? And you know, there really aren't any easy short time frame solutions. Affordable housing is tough. It's complicated. It takes a long time. I think some of the community land trust that your staff is proposing is an interesting way to look at retaining long-term affordability. So you can spend the money fairly quickly to get control of land or buy land. Of course, that doesn't turn into housing like that. It's, you know, still a long-term solution getting the housing done. It still takes a couple years. I know there's been conversation about the other support that you could do to help homeless people, sort of more immediate rental subsidy type help, and I think there's room for some component of the program to be like that. I just want to caution you about that's probably the least leveraged way to use the resources. I mean, there's a big upside, which is immediately taking one particular family and possibly getting them into affordable housing quickly. But it puts pressure on the rest of the market. It separates haves from have-nots even more. You know, if you're in possession of a rent subsidy that allows you to pay the landlord essentially, you know, $900 a month, and the poor family who makes just as much as you next door is, you know, can only afford to pay $500 a month, you're putting upward pressure on rents if you put a lot of tenant-based vouchers in the in the system quickly. So, you know, it's kind of tempting to say let's get people off the street. Get some vouchers out there. It's that has an up, you know, has a downside, and it basically helps the landlords make more money, potentially for the same unit, but it doesn't give you any long-term affordability there, you know, on an ongoing basis. So that's the least leverage approach. There are some interim, you know, pieces you could do, a more project-based approach if you wanted to use a more of a rent subsidy type model where you're actually helping the individual tenant afford the rent in that unit rather than doing like a tax credit program and getting all those unit rents set at a specific level. You could, but I'd say do it in a more project-based approach where you're negotiating a pool of units with a developer that you're using that pool of units to get a longer term than just as long as we keep paying you the voucher. So there are some solutions that might be a little bit more like a project-based voucher solution. I think they're worth exploring. They're complicated. So anyway, I just want to throw that out there. The tenant-based throwing the vouchers out is probably not the best. I think this fits really well with the RDA's goals in their communities because I really think quality affordable housing is a great tool for redevelopment and economic development. It's often the first new construction in a community. And I talk about all across the country. It's a tax credit, low-income housing project with all the equity that comes with it is sometimes in neighborhoods is the first new project that's been built in, you know, 50 years or something, and then economic activity starts happening around it. So I don't think it's anything like, oh, it's affordable housing that's bad for a neighborhood. If it's done well, it's good for a neighborhood, especially a neighborhood where there hasn't been a lot of new investment. So just want to say that's pretty typically a tool that cities are using for economic development in neighborhoods. And then, let's see, another point I had was just when you're looking for incentives for developers, whether it's getting renovation of shabby units or whether it's new construction, I'd say you want to look at sort of carrot and stick at the same time. Another way to leverage. If you're just looking at, well, let's see if we can use our money to fix up apartment buildings, you may not get what you're paying for if you don't accompany that with some code enforcement activity. I mean, if you're just, again, making it more, you're putting money out there to buy shabby buildings to fix them up, I think you're going to get less for your money than if you got that accompanied by some pressure on the shabbiest units to get them fixed up. And then you're coming in with, well, then we've got this program that will help you do that. It's lower interest loans or something like that. So I think that can apply to new construction as well. If you've got areas of the city that you say, we know these are going to be good neighborhoods for housing, if you're going to build in this and it's an RDA area and we're providing whatever resources you're coming to the RDA for, then we want to see a certain percentage of that housing affordable. And that's you're defining already, you do have to do some affordable housing in order to get our land or whatever for your project. Then you can also provide the incentives, but you've already established that they're going to be doing that housing. Your incentives will go further then. Instead of just saying, you're going to do market rate? Oh, instead, how much do we have to pay you to do some of those units affordable? That's not a great even negotiating place to be in. So they're going to say, yeah, we want to make all the money we thought we were going to make. So pay me to do that because I'm not going to make money on these units. So I just think that you've got to do the carrot and stick on both kinds. The only other thing I saw in your list of questions was something about CRA, about Community Reinvestment Act. And I don't even know who did the questions, but we saw the email. And I just want to say Salt Lake is really lucky that it's one of the strongest CRA markets in the country. We have way more than normal amounts of lenders. Some of them aren't traditional banks, but of large financial institutions of various kinds, like credit card companies or auto loan companies that aren't even traditional banks, but they have a community reinvestment obligation, and we have probably the most per capita of that almost in the country. Maybe New York City has a little bit more, but when I tell people in other parts of the country what kind of CRA demand we have here and what kind of tax credit pricing we get here, they can't believe it because they think of Utah as kind of the middle, kind of like, why would it be the same as Kansas? And instead, we get 30 or 40 cents on the dollar more than Kansas. We get way more than Colorado. So because of that, we do have a lot of CRA demand. I guess what that doesn't boil down to usually is a lot of grant money. It's not free money. The banks are told they have to make investments and loans in community projects. They don't have to be affordable housing, but affordable housing is certainly one of them. But it still comes down to we get better tax credit pricing. We may have more interest in lenders to do lower cost lending. They might be a little bit more, might be willing to push themselves a little bit more to do loans that in other parts of the country they wouldn't do. But it doesn't, unfortunately, it doesn't boil down to a lot of free money. So I think we're already seeing the benefit of that. I'm not sure there's a way to really leverage that too much further. There are funds. My organization has one that we can do some lending out of. It's not again, they lend us the money to turn around and lend it, so it's not free money, and it doesn't end up going quite as far as, you know, because grant money would. But anyway, we already sort of take advantage of that market. I think that's why you see a lot more interest in tax credit projects by the banks overall here, and that drives up that pricing. And I think that's it. I mean, I did want to emphasize that and RDA are working together, and they already are, and we work with them in doing that, and we love to keep helping. So,
thank you. Questions, board members? Stan?
Why do we have such good returns on our tax credits?
Because a lot of financial institutions see a reason to be here. It has to do with our state, the way our state treats their earnings. I mean, it's beneficial for them to be here for other reasons. Salt Lake is a good market for them. That, you know, I've heard of people say, oh, but it's also really good for employment, and I'm sure there are other reasons. But I think our state tax treatment for those banks is favorable. So we're a good place for them to come.
Other questions? I have one. Do you have one, Derek? Go ahead. Okay.
Thanks for being here. So, on leveraging and the LIHTC tax credits, who and what would be our best partner for that in the city here? And do you see any gaps that aren't being or relationships that aren't being developed already to help us get there?
Well, I mean, having Claudia here is helpful. I think that basis boost area you talked, the difficult to development area, qualified census tract areas, developers are definitely looking for those sites already. In the past, the definition of the qualified census tract is a census tract that has higher poverty. So that kind of works against what really most cities are trying to do, which is get more affordable housing in the better neighborhoods and less affordable housing in the neighborhoods that already have high poverty rates. So that is just a problem with the program overall. But then the state has the ability, and that's, you know, what our state tax credit allocation agency has done, is said we're going to give that bonus in addition to, or not in addition, but we're going to also bonus the transit-oriented development. I think this move toward the areas of opportunity is a great one, and I think the city can take advantage of that, frankly. I think there'll be other communities around the state that will be a little bit annoyed that it will be easier in a city that, one, has some other resources, like you're talking about putting out there, will help our developers be more competitive to get those sites. They'll be able to potentially have another resource to help them afford to pay for those sites, and then we probably will have more locations where we can take advantage of. So I think that's probably your primary part. And then we already have most of the top developers in the tax credit developers in the state. A lot of them are working here in Salt Lake already. So I think that's kind of happening. I think the shift to the areas of opportunity is gonna help the city for a while. It won't be forever. I'd say we better take advantage of it while it's there, because the rural parts of the state will eventually, you know, go back to Claudia and her organization and say, wait, you know, you gotta change this. Salt Lake can't have all the tax credits. So I don't know if that answered your question.
Yeah, that helps.
I'd appreciate it if you didn't do that.
Another thing that I just wanted to touch on when we're considering this affordable housing money from the RDA, you know, I personally feel quite strongly, as you mentioned, that this ought to be tied to economic development initiatives. And so if you have any additional thoughts on how we might, you know, amplify the brick and mortar construction of affordable housing so that we may drive further, you know, investments in the community. I would love to hear additional thoughts there, or if you have anything that comes to you in the middle of the night, you can send them our way.
Give me a little time. Yeah, I think a lot of sort of the general public doesn't necessarily know the difference between a low-income housing tax credit project and what they think of as low-income housing, which often is non-subsidized, just shabby housing. And so it's harder for general public to understand that, for the most part, those projects are economic generators because they're generally better quality than what a strictly, you know, market rate type development can afford to be. In a lot of cases, they're building at a little bit higher quality level because of the long-term nature of them. There isn't so much, you don't really benefit by making them cheaper. The individual developer doesn't necessarily make more developer fee. There's a limit on that already. So there's not as much incentive to try to squeeze the construction costs. And so I think that already kind of happens. The other thing that happens is if the housing is affordable to the people that are in it, they are more stable. They don't have to move as often. You know, they shouldn't, they don't move as often. They know they have a scarce resource and they have more money to spend on other things. So I think they kind of, by their very nature, are already economic generators. I mean, there are things that cities try to do, like put more retail on the ground floor. Some neighborhoods that can work. In other neighborhoods, that's not a good solution. Sometimes you're ending up subsidizing the retail, which is usually not what you're, you know, wanting to do. So again, I don't know if I answered the question.
Thank you.
Okay.
Other questions? I have one. Do you? You said that you've worked with inclusionary zoning, and I'd be interested to know, when we went on a fact-finding trip to Denver about a year ago, the developers in downtown Denver said inclusionary zoning had not worked well for them, or really in the area. I also had the opportunity to read, call it a white paper, that was written by an expert from Salt Lake about housing that was came out about a year ago in October, and the analysis there was that there are some places that it could work really well, and there are some places that it won't necessarily work, and TODs seem to be a place where they would work well. Can you just talk to us a little bit about your thoughts on inclusionary zoning?
Sure. So I worked for a nonprofit in San Diego for many, many years, and a lot of our opportunities came from the fact that they're the redevelopment agencies, which aren't there anymore, but they had to provide 20% of the housing in their redevelopment areas had to be affordable. I was the director of a nonprofit. If a developer was going to do housing, they often turned to us to do their affordable component because they didn't necessarily want to get into that mess. Mercy Housing, just actually the last project I did working for Mercy Housing was in Denver, was actually in the old Stapleton development area. It was, which is all brand new and mostly high-end housing. Mercy Housing's done several projects there. I was working on a project called Bluff Lake. It's 100 units of affordable housing, half of which are available to homeless families. No way would that have gone into that community without a requirement. The master developer in Stapleton was required to put a portion for affordable housing. That developer was doing high-end homeownership type housing, and they didn't want to do the tax credit housing. They basically said, here's the site, how much subsidy you need to do, the units that I need to say that I'm required to do in this community. And that's why Mercy Housing, you know, was able to develop and own 100 units in that very nice community next to a nature center and brand new schools. And so, you know, in those kind of areas, I think it's about the only way you get affordable housing in those really high opportunity areas. I don't know how else you do it. So I also know some of the downside arguments. I mean, I went to graduate school, and, you know, housing was my field then, and that's all anybody in California was talking about then. And it was sort of 50-50 whether people thought it was a complete disaster or whether it was the best way to get affordable housing. And so I do know they're different. But in newer communities where you're starting kind of over putting housing in, I think it's really the best way to make sure you're going to get affordable housing in the mix instead of waiting till all the market rate stuff is there and then trying to figure out how the heck you can wedge some affordable housing in there somewhere.
Thank you. Further questions for Amy? Okay, thanks, Stan.
Could you talk a little bit to the factor of the scarcity of housing stock at market rate and how that influences affordability? The reports we're seeing is that we're at a 4% vacancy rate with our rentals in the city, and what does that do to affordability?
Yeah, I mean, that's probably the thing. When I say it's a little scary to think about some sort of project-based voucher or tenant-based voucher, because our housing market is so tight, it seems like the last thing you want to do is do something else that causes it to even get tighter. There are market cycles. This one is going to end, and it's interesting to be talking about what we're trying to do and trying to incentivize market rate developers to do affordable. This is probably the hardest time to talk about that because they have their earning expectations about why they're doing a market rate project, and you're basically saying, well, I'm going to compensate you for that expectation, which, you know, it's going to be cyclical, and maybe 5 years from now, some of those really great market rate units aren't going to be quite at the price they're not going to be renting them for what they thought they were going to, or they're going to have some units vacant. It gets easier to do those kind of projects when the market's, you know, heading this way. So But when it's going this way is when you want to be doing maybe something that's a little more like the inclusionary housing requirements, where you're saying, but if we're going to give you some benefit, zoning density, or you know, we're going to give you land cost write down, that's when you probably are most, you know, that's when you can do those inclusionary requirements.
And are you familiar with any municipalities that are actually skilled at incentivizing their housing based on those market cycles? I mean, it seems like, you know, the traditional government rhetoric is that we're 10 years behind the cycle. By the time government's doing it, it's something, there's something new already happening in the market. So
yeah, or it's really, you know, as the market starts to go down, you have developers going, oh my gosh, if you hit us one more thing, you know, we're all going to leave. And so I can't say I see anybody who's really timed that perfectly. I mean, you kind of have to take a deep breath and say, we're going to do this now because we know this is coming. You know, as far as the inclusionary, you have to be ready to do it when it doesn't look like the best thing in the world, and know that it's in place for the next time the market goes up again. But no, I can't. You know, I really, everybody struggles with this, I think.
Okay. Amy, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Now we'd like to invite Dan up from Housing Authority to, and go ahead and introduce yourself and give us a little bit of your background. And thank you for coming to meet with us.
Sure. Dan Ackerman, I'm the Executive Director of the City Housing Authority, your Housing Authority. I have worked at five other housing authorities, as I mentioned at our last meeting, all of them in California. My staff, as I mentioned, makes me pay a quarter every time I mention California because they're so tired of hearing about it. I'd like to tell them Amy's mention of California is on her, not on my tab. We are very excited to be part of the housing plan here. I also want to remind people that we have a very active development arm and have had for many years. And I'm going to go into a little bit of that. I'm going to make this pretty brief since you're running long today. Background.
Take the time you want. We've planned to go long if we need to. So.
Oh, well, thank you.
Till tomorrow.
I'll slow
whatever.
Down a little.
Yeah. You know, within reason, but I don't want you to feel shortchanged because you were third up.
We
want to hear what you have to
say. I'm here every day, all day for this city. So there's 3,200 housing authorities in the U.S. Ours relies maybe 75% to 80% on federal funding, no real direct funding from the city. We own 1,572 units, many of them developed with some of the partners that are here talking today. We also manage 3,000 vouchers with private landlords, and we pay over 2,000 landlords every month to help house low-income people. About 400 of those are permanent supportive housing. So we house about 9,000 people as we sit here today, and that is, I'm proud to say, that number is growing, the amount of people we house, even though some of the funding sources, like the traditional HUD funding sources, have been shrinking. And a vast majority of the people we house are seniors, veterans, previously homeless, children, and persons with disabilities. I'd like to talk today. I was asked, I got a list of questions about neighborhood issues, and I'd like to just touch on that first. There is a movement both at the state and at the federal level to really invest into neighborhoods of opportunity. In fact, the Affirmatively Furthering Fair Housing, I like to say that fast once I learned how to say it, final rule came out less than a year ago, and it really emphasizes the same thing. Site and neighborhood standards is what HUD calls it, and they're going to be focusing federal money on the neighborhoods that have better schools and better jobs and better opportunities. There's a pretty famous study by Raj Chetty from, he was at Harvard, now he, before winter hit, he moved to Stanford. But he shows the impacts on young children that neighborhoods have. And really, the whole country has jumped on that bandwagon. That also means, by the way, that there'll be a disinvestment in poor neighborhoods. Now, not everyone would agree with that, but there's only so much money, and if you invest in one neighborhood, you're not investing in another. I'd like to talk to you and the public about how much is happening under your leadership. I think as you focus on the things to come, you don't realize how much is already happening under your leadership. And as an example, we just received 449 new vouchers for homeless veterans. We opened a 112-unit senior development this summer on West Temple, again with Claudia and a lot of the same partners that are here, including HAND and the Redevelopment Agency. Since I last met with you, we have filled up most of our homeless veteran properties. That was a big issue. We had to work extra hard with the VA. And as an example, Freedom Landing is now full for the first time in its history, 109 units. We have the 9th East Lofts, a very great partnership with the Redevelopment Agency, with the RDA. That's 68 family units that are opening at 444 South, 900 East. HAND, the Housing Trust Fund, Utah Housing Corp, Olean Walker Fund, Utah Community Investment Corp. Again, many of the same partners. It'll be open on March 5th, 2017. We already have 50 of the 68 units leased.
Yeah, and how many of those are affordable? And at what
100% affordable.
What percentage? Is it 80% of
89? No, it's targeting 60% and below. And then we have some set-aside units at even a lower target rate.
What is that target rate? Do you remember?
I have it here. I'll look it
up.
We
can talk afterwards,
yeah.
Though.
We are also partnering with Road Home and Cowboy Partners and the Redevelopment Agency and HAME and HAND on what you have six or eight names for, and that would be the, I'll only give two or three of them. That would be the Northwest Pipeline, the Violin School Commons, the Gas Building, but anyway, that's on 300 East and 200 South. As soon as Claudia gives us tax credits later this week, that project will be ready to go, or not ready to go, but moving really fast. And there's at least 80 units of permanent supportive housing in that property under your leadership for the previously homeless. The Housing Authority has invested over $8 million in subsidy for that project, working with Mike here. We also have, we're working with the RDA preliminarily on the Station Center project. That's 500 West, 300 South. That's a TOD site, a very big mixed-use site. Very similar, the leveraging you talked about, the Housing Authority's role in that project, if we're successful, will be to stimulate economic development on those blocks. There's already other partners kind of waiting for somebody to take the first big step. That would be somewhere between 84 and 197 affordable units based on schematic drawings. I think Bridge and ArtSpace and some other known developers are already involved in that mixed-use site. It's a very exciting site. You know, there's a pedestrian orientation, historic fabric throughout, some community function space. Definitely a TDA project that will probably qualify greatly for 9% credits. A museum, office space, pretty excited. We have recently are about to tie up six parcels on West Temple and Paxton. That's almost 1 acre. That's going to cost us well over $1 million. That's next to two properties we already own that have 168 affordable units. We're talking to the County Housing Authority about redeveloping City Plaza, a 300-unit senior site, either using outside developers or getting it out of the old public housing program and into something more modern, interestingly called RAD, the Rental Assistance Demonstration Program. And then we're also pursuing some other parcels, one of them not far from the new sites you announced today. There's other ways we're helping with the homeless response. We have a domestic violence preference on our waiting list. Excuse me. One in five homeless people experience of domestic violence, and 25% of those are children. We have set aside units in our market rate units to help with the harder to house and the previously homeless. We have some very specific homeless programs like VASH, Shelter Plus Care, HOPWA, Family Unification Program. We're working with HAND and have some initiatives, new initiatives that we think will really help and be part of this plan. I'm not prepared to talk in detail about those, but we do have a lot of detail on them. As an example, the local voucher program that you've been talking about, we think housing navigators are a great investment, meaning this world of housing is so complex. If we can hold the hand of residents and landlords and make that connection, people will be housed quicker.
So will you define for us, so a housing navigator is an actual person, not a tool on the computer?
Yes, it's usually, and it's an older term now. We like, housing navigators used to be social workers that would work with housing, hard-to-house tenants and try to place them. The more modern versions on the East Coast especially are more like real estate professionals who know the market, they know the complex housing programs, they know how to kind of market to landlords and help landlords accept these types of things. So they're usually people. And there are some that are funded now by the continuum of care, but we think that's a great investment because it gets people in housing faster and removes all this complexity that you have actually started to understand more than ever these days.
So have you been in conversations with the county about how to expand that program through continuum of care? Are they, and I'm assuming they're currently funded through some county source.
Well, the continuum of care is really everybody, not just the county. And we are converting some of our own staff temporarily to housing navigators, two staff members, through a kind of a temporary initiative that our commission just approved. But we will be aggressively looking for navigators on behalf of this. The housing ombudsperson is a similar idea.
So my understanding with the new model of the resource centers for homelessness is that there would be case management and potentially something very much like this position housed in a facility like that that could help people individually once they find themselves in a resource center navigate finding additional resources for housing. So I'm just wondering how can the city facilitate making that connection to however we're funding that through the service provider. Maybe that's something, Mike, that we want to track in our housing plan. Mike Ackerlow.
Yes, this will all be sort of integrated into the strategic master plan. To put it in perspective, at my last agency, we had 14 housing navigators. Now, granted, some of those were for special veteran grants or special grants to get homeless families housed. But another great way is to have those persons, very mobile and very not sitting in an office. We have some incentives we're proposing as kind of set-asides for specific types of homeless families. On the landlord incentives that was brought up today, we have a very developed landlord incentive package that we're working with the Apartment Association on, and we think that is key also to, even though Amy makes a fantastic point that this is the hardest time to get private landlords involved in the hardest to house, if you incentivize it six or eight different ways, it can happen. We are excited about the community land trust idea, and we've got experience in that at our agency. We are going to talk about kind of the code enforcement and maybe receivership type programs that you heard a little sprinkling of today. We think a pre-development pool for being nimble in competing with other developers is important. And as was brought up earlier today, there's a lot of untapped resources in the Valley that are going to take some marketing and fairly formal relationship building in order to have those cities and towns and other parts of the county step up to the plate and help. The principles we use on all of this are leveraging, as you mentioned, not just paying straight up for things, try to leverage. The Housing First principle is one of ours. A sense of urgency is a principle that if you ask my staff for these, they will have that memorized. Stability for households. I mentioned the Raj Chetty reports. You'd be amazed how many kind of social ills come out of unstable housing, whether it's children educational levels or health issues. The more we can stabilize where people stay in place. And we really like your leadership in targeting lower incomes. As money is short, unfortunately, we have to really focus on the most desperate. It'd be great if it wasn't that way. We are excited about a lot of the positive elements, including the unified leadership that we see in this valley. You're so close to the flame, it may not seem very unified. To us, it does. It seems like you have your homeless response, your affordability, the workforce, growth and economy, quality of life are omnipresent, environmental sensitivity, transparency, business support. You don't see that in many communities. You know, a lot of communities are focused on their own budget, traffic, crime, and so it's very refreshing to us to see what we see as fairly unified leadership. The community itself seems concerned and engaged with these issues of housing. There's a recent Utah Foundation, very recent Utah Priority Project that most citizens, or 53% of citizens, have a high level of concern, 4 out of 5 points, regarding homelessness and poverty. And then finally, there are some emerging funding sources that we're excited about, like your carve out of the 17.1 or plus 4, if you want to call it that, your possible consideration of levy or bond issues, the Lieutenant Governor's proposed state tax credit increase, and then there's still a federal bill floating around by our own senator, the Cantwell Hatch bill, to increase the 9% credits nationwide. So I just wanted to cover those issues with you, and my main point being there's a lot happening, there's a lot that's going to happen, and we're here to help.
Thank you so much. Additional questions, board members? Thank you so much
Sure.
for the service you render in our city. You make a huge difference, and your organization is great, and we really appreciate it.
Sure, so, thank you.
Thank you. And I'm going to invite Laura Fritz to come up for just a couple minutes, our economic development director. And I've asked her specifically to just give us a little bit of a teaser, perhaps, for what she's going to have to say later. But I wanted to talk for a minute about ways in which affordable housing aligns with economic development and redevelopment goals, because she's familiar with both of those, and I'd like the public to have a chance to hear that as well. Thank you, Laura, so much for doing this.
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. Thank you for inviting me to the table. Economic development really did contemplate affordable housing as part of our work plan. And the reason why we did that was really twofold. One, we sort of saw this as an opportunity to be able to stabilize a workforce. We looked at it as a way to direct income toward shopping and enhancing economic development opportunities. And then last but not least, we really looked at it as an opportunity, as you heard from our partners today, as a way to kickstart investment in areas that may not have investment today. So in two areas of the work plan, we really called out affordable housing. And so in the first area was through business development. And again, we talked a little bit just a moment ago about workforce. I feel that workforce housing is so important to this community. If I'm a student who's making $50,000 a year, just came out of college, got my first job at one of our great employers, and I'm making $50,000 a year.
You're lucky if you're making $50,000.
You're lucky if you're making $50,000. I know, I sure didn't.
Not a teacher.
I sure didn't. And teachers definitely do not. How do I live in the city when housing does not afford me to live here? And what we want to do is we want to keep our employees here. We want them shopping in our stores. We want them going to our restaurants. And we want them working and living in the same community. So from a workforce development standpoint, it was really important to us. From an economic incentive standpoint, we felt it was really important to engage economic development as part of the conversation for affordable housing. And part of the reason why is because we do have these amazing tools through the RDA. So let's figure out the way forward. And you know, kudos to Mike Arcolo and Mike Rayberg for putting together this plan that you'll see has the RDA's fingerprints in ways that we can partner together to move affordable housing forward. A second area that we really contemplated affordable housing was within placemaking. And there were three areas within the placemaking conversation in our work plan where we called out affordable housing. The first area was initiating private sector investments. Again, you heard today a lot of conversation about leveraging. What a great opportunity for economic development to leverage the tools that are out there. We don't have to do it all ourselves, but what we can do is capital stack a project in a way that's really meaningful for a developer. The next area is we wanted to make sure that we have a community that's economically accessible for all. And how do we do that? Well, we have to make sure that there's housing available for all, that there's jobs available for all, that there's opportunities to get groceries for all. So we wanted to make sure that we were looking at affordable housing as a component of that. And then one of the things that we're starting to have a conversation about is because we do have these resources available through the Utah Housing Corporation for federal tax credits and state tax credits, what are we doing on the commercial side? And so one of the things that Justin and I had originally started talking about a couple weeks ago is the idea of becoming a community development entity, which would allow us to be able to apply for new market tax credits, which would help to incentivize commercial development so that you have the housing and commercial working together to revitalize neighborhoods. And then last but not least, policies and procedures. You heard Mike Arcolo talk about zoning. We can't lose sight of the fact that by improving our policies and procedures, more development can occur. And so, you know, beyond zoning, we need to be looking at things like the land disposition policy you adopted recently. I think there's a number of tools that we can bring to bear on affordable housing, and we're going to continue to work on that. So last but not least, I want to finalize my thoughts by saying that people want to live in neighborhoods and communities that have jobs and stores and restaurants. And so while affordable housing is a piece of that, we have to make sure that we're not looking at it as just solely one piece of it. It really has to be all of it to make it a vibrant community. Thank you for letting me come up.
Thank you so much. Questions for Director Fritz? All right.
I have a quick comment, I should say.
Okay, go ahead.
Dan from the Housing Authority mentioned Station Center, that project there. And a partnership to build some affordable housing and use that as a catalyst for that project area. Do you have thoughts on how we might move forward on that sooner rather than later using the RDA funds that we've set aside?
Well, it's a good news. One of the things that we had added to the agenda was just to let you know that we were going to engage in this conversation as part of that new land disposition policy. So we are just starting those conversations, but we're looking forward to seeing how we can utilize potentially some of the money that has been set aside. Again, those great tax credits that are available, and really stacking a project that makes financial and economic sense.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anything else? I don't know about you all, board members, but I feel like this has been very, very helpful, and I'm going to editorialize for a minute. I'm really disappointed that I don't see anyone from the press here. They're out knocking on doors to see if people are mad that homeless shelters are going by them, and I'm sure they're getting the answers they want. But this was a really important conversation, and I so appreciate your help with lining it up. Appreciate all of those of you who are willing to come and share with us. We care passionately about making housing work in Salt Lake City for the whole spectrum of people who are here. We want people who work for Salt Lake City to be able to live here. We do care about that workforce housing. We really care about that missing middle. And I'm just really sorry that no one's here to cover it. Maybe they'll listen to the tape and we'll talk about it so people can know that we are trying to move forward. Everyone wants us to solve these huge, huge problems in 5 minutes and in the way that least impacts their lives, instead of realizing we're talking about real people with real problems and real needs that we are trying to meet. So thank you, all of you. And with that, I'll get off my soapbox. And that was the report from the chair and the vice chair, unless the vice chair has something else to say. And so we will move to the last item on the agenda, item B8, and that would be report and announcements from staff. So Justin, go ahead, and if you have anyone else to share anything.
Thank you. I'd like to invite Carol Lindsley up to the table to provide information to you about Parcel 3 in the Station Center development and the Depot District project area.
Maybe.
Sorry, I'm just looking for the flash drive here. Oh, I do? Okay. Oh.
Here we go.
All right, thank you. As part of the real property disposition policy that you all adopted in October, we have a few opportunities to update the board on the disposition process for Tier 1 properties. So I am here to talk about the Station Center Parcel 3, which is shown in the bottom right corner of that map. It's been discussed a little bit already tonight, but basically just wanted to provide a predisposition report, which is one of the opportunities we have to update the board under this policy. The other two are when a developer has been selected, and let's see, last one is when we sign a development agreement with the developer. So one of the things we talk about in the predisposition report is the property's reuse plan. As we've talked about tonight, we're in preliminary discussions with the Housing Authority to build a residential project on Parcel 3, which will include affordable housing. We don't have a precise mix of level of affordability and mix of units at this point, but that's something that we'll determine during negotiations with the Housing Authority and also in collaboration with HAND as we move forward in this process. The method of disposition for this property is, this is one of the situations where we can exclusively negotiate with a developer because we are talking to either a nonprofit or a government agency. Housing Authority is a special purpose government agency, and we can do that when the final disposition of the policy of the property is for community or public use. And because they develop affordable housing, that is our community use for this property. The timeline here is we will begin negotiating an exclusive negotiations agreement with the Housing Authority, and then come back in January for the next update when a developer is selected, and we consider that to be when we enter into the exclusive negotiations agreement with them. In the event that the Housing Authority requests a write-down of the property value, we'll come back to the board at that time for board approval of the write-down. And we are hoping to enter into an option to purchase agreement with them in July, or by July. They have indicated in our discussions that they would like to apply for low-income housing tax credits with UHC, and those are due in October. And with that timeline, we would have a potential groundbreaking summer 2018, and then hopefully the project would open around fall of 2019. And what else was I going to take you on? The predisposition report also has some other relevant information. It's included in your packets. Do you guys want me to tell you? I mentioned some environmental and infrastructure information that's related to this disposition, if you'd like to hear that. Yeah? Oh, you're good. Okay.
I may just add that although this parcel is part of the overall station center development and certainly benefits from the network of infrastructure improvements that we've discussed with you previously, it's not reliant upon those improvements, and I think we have a path forward to develop Parcel 3 on its own and continue our discussions about the funding for infrastructure for the rest of Station Center. Certainly, this project would benefit from those improvements, and I think, likewise, the rest of the neighborhood would benefit from this project getting underway. So we're really enthusiastic about the opportunity to begin discussions with the Housing Authority, and I think the timeline that Kara described really, we're benefiting significantly from the steps that you've taken to streamline and refine our property disposition policy, and we're putting into action, and I think really shortening the time frame. If this were done through a conventional RFP process, I think you could safely add 4 to 6 months onto that timeline that Kara had described. So that's a real way in which we're gaining traction very quickly in addressing our affordable housing, and that's attributable to the work that we've all done to address that through policy changes to our loan program, or sorry, land disposition program.
Questions, board members? All right, thank you so much. That's very helpful. And is there anything else anybody wants to bring forward? Then with that, we will adjourn the RDA meeting. Thank you so much.